Look out. Cats are...
Shoot it up.
Feisty today.
Yeah. Well, Mittens is missing me. She's lonely.
You're poor a cold God. And distant stepfather.
Stepfather?
Well, she's not my real child. I don't know if you can't tell.
She hasn't earned your approval.
So, she's a cat. And
so do we need the headsets? Or?
You can wear headphones if you want.
Hear myself back? Will I sound better or worse?
No. You'll sound just like you.
Just like me?
Yeah.
Well, I sound just like me right now.
Yeah.
So I don't...
The headphones there, the jacks on the stand, you don't
but
have
if I,
to.
If I don't need it, then I'm fine without it.
I wear it to make sure that things sound okay.
Okay. Well, you know what you're doing.
I am terrible talking into a mic stand, and I just have to hold it.
That's fine with me.
Yeah.
I don't enjoy it either.
Yeah, it feels awkward to me, and so I move my head to look at, because I look at people when we're talking rather than just talking
and
right
that's
the
almost
mic.
Why I'd like you to start wearing headphones, just because you do
be more aware.
Do that, yeah. And if you're all, then you'll hear it.
Maybe I could get just a headset and look really cool.
Well, you don't want to mess up your hair.
Yeah. cancer joke.
Well, we're on Facebook Live. I can't make the joke.
What's that one?
You know.
Oh, that joke.
I get in trouble. Mm-hmm. The chemo for your...
By who? Yeah, I know. We're Facebook Live right now?
We are.
We're live. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Let's see.
Waiting for Chris Spangle.
Alive.
So we're going to talk Hurricane. We're going to talk
the response.
Yes.
There's an interesting philosophical discussion in that, too.
Okay.
Think about it without a monopoly, you know, so from perspective of a monopoly government agency and for disaster relief, what would the alternative from a libertarian perspective look like?
Exactly.
Maybe at some point after that, talk a little bit about the Hillary PAC that's spending five times the Johnson budget on hit ads on Gary Johnson. Have you heard that?
No.
That's news to me.
In eight swing states, a pro-Hillary PAC is spending $50 million to...
annihilate Gary Johnson.
Yes, and his whole campaign budget is $10
million. Well, spent $30,000 on memes.
Apparently the Rolling Stone hit piece didn't do the job, or Mother Jones.
The day we started threatening the left was... We were in trouble.
Yeah,
because they're way more vicious than the right.
Can you throw the headphones on for me?
Sure.
Because you're a mic wanderer too. So if you have the headphones on,
I'll have less wandering.
That's exactly right.
I've got you guys on either side of me.
Yes.
So.
Yeah.
I know.
And you told me where to plug this in, and
It's right there with the red. Yeah. Right in that little hole there.
Got it.
And it's the volume's right here, so you can adjust there.
So they're going to spend how many? 10 times the...
50 million, and his whole budget is 10 million total. It was in the New York Times.
That's his whole budget? 10 million?
Mm-hmm.
Is that, how much more is that than last time?
10 times.
That's what I thought.
I think he only... Does that sound good?
Yeah, no, it sounds fine.
All right,
yeah.
Good. Good. Okay.
Sounds great. So 10 million, and how much of that's federal money? How much of that's his own money?
He's not in the finance.
Yeah, he doesn't get public finance. We have to get 5% to get it.
Yep.
Which hopefully we do.
Yeah.
Boy, I hope.
We don't want public financing.
It's our money. We want it back.
That's right.
It's like Social Security.
Right. Honestly. Right.
It is.
And if I'm, if I had to pay for it with the, I was forced to pay for something with the expectation of getting it back, then I don't have a problem with that.
And if you're a green voter, you should get your green money back.
Yeah.
Right.
And then Ron Paul will endorse you.
It wasn't an endorsement.
I know. It fully triggered Spangle. I've never, because he already doesn't love the Ronimal. And when he did that, it was the immediate. I hate the Pauls. I wish the Pauls would just die.
It's true.
Well, they've got their problems, They're with folks in our movement.
Yeah.
And elsewhere.
You know what's funny is and this is so hypocritical as a libertarian, but I don't know. I know so little about the Green Party. Like I don't even consider them like a formal party.
Yeah. They ran Cynthia.
They're like a Tea Party.
That's right. They ran Cynthia
McKinney 4 years.
Didn't they run Roseanne Barr?
Roseanne Barr.
No way, really?
Yeah,
I
didn't
know
that. She was
think it was 4 years ago.
Against McCain, right? Or was she? But yeah, like.
Well, that makes sense.
But that is so hypocritical. It's like,
well, that was
you guys aren't really a party. You don't need to be in the debates. Just go away. Let's have Gary.
No, Jill
Stein. He'll represent the Greens.
You got to remember, they had Ralph Nader.
And, that was their claim to fame.
2000. I mean, think of the Hanging Chads were, if it hadn't been for the Green Party.
Okay. It was 96 and 2000. It was Nader. Mm-hmm. And then Cobb, McKinney, Jill Stein. And Jill Stein, I have a lot of respect for.
She's got a knack for the soundbite.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Roseanne.
She was crushing Hillary. You know, her best, common reason to vote for Hillary is she's not Donald Trump.
I would not mind seeing Jill Stein in the debates at all.
That'd be no. Cool. And she represents them really well. I my fear is she'd outperform Gary.
They have some, and probably so.
But Barr lost, she came in second to Jill Stein and lost the nomination.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
But don't forget that their economic policies are somewhere far to the left of Bernie Sanders on the whole. So
it's basically like communes.
I think, though, they'd be more about ending the Fed than any other party ever.
You think?
Well, I think they like the idea of locally traded currencies or local exchange trading systems.
Really?
Oh yeah,
that's one of the big
I don't want to ascribe principles to that.
Greens that I know.
Oh yeah, so I worked with the Michigan Land Use Institute when I was in Traverse City, Michigan, and they were all about the Bay coins or whatever, Bay bucks, you know, where you traded local money and screw, you know, American currency.
Operate outside the existing currency.
Yeah, which was one of the things I loved about it.
It undermines the dollar and taxation.
Well, I don't know. You know, undermine the dollar, yeah. And taxation, okay, I'm with you on that.
Yeah.
All the way around.
I don't have a problem.
No.
I can handle competing currencies.
Yeah. And they don't necessarily have to be currencies the way it works out. I mean, you got bartering systems and, you know, the whole, So
Who made them? Was there like an issuing authority?
Or
do you remember?
You know, there was a committee. It was privately. It was the Uber of money at the time. It was before Bitcoin. Nobody had heard of Bitcoin. There was no Bitcoin.
Yeah.
There was no blockchain back then.
Yeah.
So
that's the real. I mean, that's the one that's
threat.
made it real. It's like rather than local and
it's exciting.
One-offs. I think it's so exciting.
I don't know how long we're going to be on tonight, but we could talk the whole night about Bitcoin and the Fed.
Stopping wars by actual fiscal discipline. That's the whole game. Ron Paul did get that right. In the Fed, the rest sort of falls into place.
I will hang myself if we do that. I can't.
Are you all right over there?
Come on now.
Don't get triggered.
Oh, I'm about. That's going to happen.
What happened?
I just found out that it's a Soros-backed super PAC.
Yeah.
Surprise.
Damn Soros.
Why would you be shocked?
Because
about
I've
that?
Been listening to a lot of Alex Jones lately.
Yeah,
so
you have.
I'm full trigger.
He was earlier today, he was talking about how the Bushes were the bagmen for Nazi gold in South America.
I was
look it up. Look it up. It's on Washington Post. Look it up.
I was mimicking Jones. Because it's so
we need a revolution.
It's so silly that the Bushes took the Nazi gold and that's anyways. He's insane.
Uh-oh. I feel like the more you listen to Alex Jones, the more you're going to give him credibility. Because you're already a Glenn Beck sympathizer.
I am. I totally am. I think Glenn Beck...
What's going on with you, Chris?
I don't
get that. Glenn Beck, seriously?
Well, I'm now anti-Bill Weld. I'm like three...
So wait, are you going to become a Mormon
I'm
next,
three joint hits away from becoming Roger Paxton.
Oh, God.
I can't find this.
Do you know him well?
I don't.
Oh, you'd like Roger. He's a great guy. But he is black and yellow. Like, so Lava Flow is his podcast, and it is libertarians, anarcho-capitalists, voluntarists, and something else.
And something else.
Agorists or agorists.
Not a bad
name. Yeah, that's who he caters to. It is. It is. They talk about, like, I love his show because they talk about, more of the stuff that's on, like, libertarian Reddit. You know, some the news stories that aren't getting covered at all other than on very, like, fringe outlets. And it's really interesting, but he definitely has a...
Lava Flow. Gotta check him out.
Yeah. They only have 616 likes.
James needs...
So how do you translate likes into how many listeners you have?
I don't know that there's actually a formula for it. I wish there were, because then it'd be easy to just... It'd be turnkey.
Well, YouTube's figured it out, right?
Yeah.
You know,
That's true. It's just that, you know, it's an additional step. Because, you know, someone's on your Facebook page, then getting them to go to the website, then getting them to subscribe to the podcast.
I mean, another thing we could talk about in terms of disrupting the economy is how these family units with these cute little kids are exploiting YouTube and making that. I have a client right now who told me she was going to get a check for $410,000.
For what?
For her beautiful daughters being on YouTube.
So. Is that exploitation?
Well, no, I mean, exploiting. No, I mean, no.
Leveraging
it's not.
YouTube to make
exactly.
an income
when
stream.
When I say exploitation, I think it's just, it's fabulous.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
They struggle forever.
I mean, it's exploitation the same way that digging up diamonds or coal from, you know.
You're exploiting Mother Earth.
Something like that.
I really need
YouTube,
to get a kid.
YouTube is becoming Mother Earth.
They struggled, though, because they couldn't. Like, they were subsidizing content creators for the longest time until they could create really a huge platform where, they, you know, it was a good enough split to keep them there.
Are they still subsidized? It would seem like they must be, given what they're paying out.
Yeah, because, I mean, at a certain point, I'm sure it's a breakdown. Like, more so, I bet, like, I actually bet 5% of the content producers make 95% of the money.
Oh, no doubt.
And so they, but they probably have to keep, like, subsidize the 15% to keep that additional 20% of good content producers on there, would be my guess.
And who's to say what's good content other than those who
are professionally made?
You know, it's like Uber. How do you decide between Uber? Did you hear Split went out of business in DC because
they couldn't
get enough ridership? So they were trying to be the low cost provider and,
Was it subsidized, or was it?
No, it wasn't subsidized. But their plan was it was all shared rides. I mean, literally shared rides. You had to be, and the only time it wasn't a shared ride was when there wasn't another person between point A and point B for them to pick up. So it was like a bus in a car.
Yeah, who would want that?
Apparently, no one.
Yeah.
So even in
it's
D.C.,
the
where
private Amtrak.
You know, when I've taken Uber in D.C., I've been picked up in a taxi cab.
Yeah.
Like, this isn't an Uber. You guys, there's some kind of fraud. And how much of this is going back to the D.C. government, which is the federal government?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It all ends up there eventually.
Well, that's true. Even if you're Uber.
In time.
Unless you've got Donald Trump's accountants working for you.
That's brilliant.
Brilliant.
The key is to be bankrupt early. And then have your success. Fail really on a massive scale.
Massive.
And then tax-free the rest of your life.
Yeah.
I can't even fault the guy.
Hopefully it's not too late for me.
If I were him, I'd have said, this was strategic. I didn't want to pay. I wanted to purposely fail on a massive level. Then I'd succeed and avoid taxation.
You know, Wesley Snipes could have had a good conversation with the Donald a few years ago and stayed out of a lot of trouble.
When was the reform they changed about... Because was it 86 when there was the
tax reform?
Yeah, the tax reform that changed the carrying forward of real estate losses. Because weren't people buying a lot of properties and then just like creating S corps on purpose in order to do it?
Well, it was limited partnerships back then.
LPs, yeah.
Yeah, and they were syndicated LPs.
Yeah.
And they were doing it with oil and gas and real estate. And the Bushes were all over that.
Oh,
They were taking advantage of that system quite nicely.
Yeah.
It seemed. And
then
the
Nazi gold.
I don't know anything about that.
Yeah, well,
look it up.
What Alex Jones said is that the Bushes took all $1 billion worth of Nazi gold to South America, and they were in charge of, and like, the Trotskyites left Russia with $1 billion in gold, and then the Bushes were in charge of distributing it. So
that's fascinating.
That's how they became.
That really is.
And he cites his
sources.
So
what's the history of the Trotskyites after...
Well, they
went to Mexico because that's where Trotsky had an axe put in his head by Stalin.
That's where he died.
And they were hanging out there.
They were
20 plus years
with $1 billion in gold just wherever they went.
They were physically removed, so to speak.
Stalin was not the thinker. Trotsky was the real, you know, Marx adherent. And then at a certain point, Stalin said, "Listen, that's great, you and your ideas. At the end of the day, we need gulags and we need to make Russia great again."
I mean, was it Stalin or Lenin that took Trotsky out?
Stalin forcibly removed them.
Yeah. And then had somebody put an axe in his head in Mexico City, I think.
Yeah, that's where he died.
Yeah.
So I cannot.
Are you struggling?
I'm trying to find the actual details of this, but I can't.
The super PAC?
Yeah, but it's really.
Is that what we're going to lead with?
No, I just want to have some facts on it because I just heard him say it in an interview, and I don't. So,
what's the latest track on the Hurrican?
Yeah,
I'll pull that up and read the news article. Anybody on Facebook Live, if you can help me out and find the Matt Welch, maybe Matt Welch tweeted it or somebody. We're looking for the info on the super PAC that is doing ads on Gary Johnson. The leads that I've got are Democratic Coalition Against Trump, Next Gen Climate PAC. So anyways, all right, we'll get started. Let's see here.
Do you think Hurricane Matthew is God punishing us for homosexual marriage?
Absolutely. I mean, no.
Dang it.
We've got to turn this live off.
There are questions I refuse to
answer. Is global warming God hugging us tighter?
Okay.
Wasn't there a Senate candidate in Indiana who stumbled over an abortion question a couple of years ago?
Yeah, that was Richard Murdoch.
Yeah, I remember. Yeah.
So are you telling me that there's divinely inspired rape?
All right, here we go.
Nice.
Got to get it all
official
out.
Kickoff.
Mm-hmm. Got to get it out. Get it out.
And you haven't even enjoyed it too hard.
Oh, I inhaled a spicy chicken sandwich, though.
That'll do it.
Yeah. They,
really?
A lot of gristle in Wendy's chicken. Oh,
yeah. Well, we'll talk about this. Yeah. Welcome to We Are Libertarians. I am your host, Chris Spangle. We Are Libertarians brings all of the irreverence modern politics deserves. We explain to you what the hell is happening in our world today and how we can fix it by thinking differently. This is a podcast brought to you by the We Are Libertarians Network. That means that we are self-funded and powered by you and me. Please be sure to rate and review us on iTunes, like us on Facebook, and share this episode with friends and support us through PayPal or Patreon at wearelibertarians.com. We are supported by listeners like you, so that $1 per episode through Patreon, when we do an episode, we get paid. That's how I pay the bills for this. So we, if you are listening for free, there ain't no such thing as a free lunch. So if you could help pledge $5 a month to help us grow, that would be tremendous. That allows us to do many more things. And we're always taking your questions and comments via email at editor@wearelibertarians.com. Yes, I do read those. I have received them. And once the election is over, we're going to have a Q&A show because we have probably half a dozen to eight different emails that we've got to. So please keep sending those in and we'll answer your questions. And as always, we just chit chat a little bit for the first 20 minutes, or as Roger Paxton calls it, fluff. We will
purist
Roger the Lava Flow podcast, as
the
you heard,
greatest amateur volcano enthusiast podcast in history.
So we chit chat a little bit so you can get to know us, and that voice you heard are the lovely pipes of Greg Lenz. Greg, how are you?
Good, buddy. How are you feeling today?
I'm a little punchy.
You're a little punchy?
Yes. I always get tense and tight right before the election, and this year is no different, even though I'm not managing any campaigns. But
are you upset about how well Mike Pence did and how the media reception's been?
I'm upset because I couldn't get Chick-fil-A for dinner.
Oh, that is a microaggression if I've ever heard of one.
I have my priorities straight, okay? You want to know that it's God's how I know it's God's favorite fast food chain? Chick-fil-A over here at Southport, which Little Brett Bittner goes to literally every night because I've seen him.
Well, he hates the gays.
Well,
hates them.
And so that's an unsubstantiated rumor.
Yeah.
Sorry. I went full Sarah Palin there for a minute. So they have this new system that's really slick.
You were complaining about it.
Well, yes, because it's I was mad because there's too many guys in this new system. You can't see all the cute Mormon chicks. So they have the system where you
started out with Baptists.
Right. Yeah. Right. Now it's Mormon girls.
And they said, "Why have one wife when you can have multiple and we don't have to pay them?" It's perfect.
And the line is that they did it to cut down the line because it was getting out of control. And so they put in two lanes. And they do it differently than McDonald's two-lane system. They have, like, runners taking payments outside and they've got someone handing. And, like, you pull in, and you're just kind of driving the whole time. I mean, and
it's a little
it's
awkward.
Efficient. Yeah.
It's a little awkward. Right. What do you think of it? Do you like it?
You know what? They used to do that at Wendy's when I was in high school. And I didn't know because I worked there, and they would send me out to collect the money.
Really?
In the line. Only they only had one line, and they still did it. So we'd take the order, collect the money, and then you'd drive around. I'm like, why are you doing that?
Huh.
And I mean, it was really bad when it was hailing outside.
Yeah. So, yeah. I was going to say, it kind of feels like the equivalent of a phone call. Like, you're specifically going to the drive-thru to avoid human interaction.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, there's this human just leaning into your window.
And they're friendly, yeah. Which is annoying.
And you could be having a bad day, and your car could be dirty, and you don't want them to look in there.
Right.
But see, this is where I'm pretty much a Green Party enthusiast, even though I'm a diehard libertarian, and I'm not going Ron Paul on anyone anytime soon, ever.
Good, because your health would be in question tonight, the way he's
feeling.
Yeah,
but I'm all about getting out of your car and walking.
Yeah. So, but it might be the case, like, where it's hailing.
But you're
like,
true. No. Good
there's
point.
There's poor Drew Thompson sitting there being hailed on.
Hey, I go through the drive-thru at Starbucks probably once a week. And if it's for nothing else, just to hear the entertainment of the guy on the voice on the other end.
Just yeah. Human interaction. So, but not, person, not face-to-face. No. Face.
It's just like this. It's voice-to-voice.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So that's all I can take.
The line is normally, you know, for our Facebook Live listeners – you know,
look at this media production.
It's amazing. Full media production.
Wow.
Over there.
Our first infographic.
We have our full corkboard over there for our 50, our Road to 270 map that we're going
to
work on later.
Road to 270.
Yeah.
We're going to have a March Madness that you're starting out empty. Map.
That means that Gary Johnson is not behind in any state.
Yeah. Are you telling me William Weld's not the candidate?
Don't get me triggered this early. So anyway, so you've got the Chick-fil-A building. And then you've got the line where you come into the two lanes, and then, you know, you circle around and you go out that way. The line was all the way out at the road, and then you swung around this way, and then you had to come in this way and get in line, and it was going to – I had to be here by 6:30 because Drew's a responsible man, okay? He was here on time.
Thank you for the endorsement.
Well, yes. I'm never on time to my own podcast at my own house.
He's usually not clothed.
No. And I'm that's never, not a joke. Never clothed.
Well, as a libertarian, I can't object to that.
You should.
Even if I'd be offended.
That's when we need a law. Pass a law. Mandatory clothing before podcasting.
So the line was all the way out to the major road. It's ridiculous. You had cars all the way down here, going all the way around here, and it was too much. And so I had to be here, so I went to Wendy's, and I got I normally get the number one large sized with pepper jack cheese and lemonade at Chick-fil-A, which, you know, you get some fries, you get some lemonade, you get some delicious chicken. And so I had to settle for second best, which is Wendy's chicken. And as Greg described it, it's
gristle-filled.
Right.
You almost, like, one time out of three, you're going to get this just hunk of gristle right in the middle. It's just disgusting.
I also like,
and their mayonnaise is gross.
We are Facebook Living this, and James' niece is trolling the entire thing, of course. And he says, unlike James' niece, who is super early, which is true, he showed up early one time, and he saw all of me.
But the point is, one of the reasons I was on time is the promises that were made to get me on the show that there would be room filled with scantily clad women, and instead I arrive here, and a cat is crawling unclothed.
Did he say women, or did he say...
These are my libertarian buttons. I got this one personally from Daryl Perry.
Now, oh God! Now, I've seen your pictures on Facebook. You guys know how to find them. So
oh yeah,
we sure do.
Yep, and well, he keeps them in his bedroom.
I don't anymore. I apparently have lost my mojo. So Drew Thompson, I didn't even introduce Drew. A rare misstep by me, who is
off his game,
Mr. Introductory over here. So we got Greg Lenz as normal. And Drew Thompson is with us. Drew is from Indianapolis. He is running for Congress in the 7th District, although we are not here to interview him as a candidate like we did with Matt. Matt, he's hanging out with us tonight, just being a part of the program. But, you know, should you get curious and want to look your candidacy up, if you like what he has to say, where would they visit you?
DrewThompson2016.com, or they can find me on Twitter at DrewThompson_16, or on Facebook at Drew Thompson for Congress.
All right, very good.
Are you one of those people that allow friend requests to your personal or no?
Yes.
Do you? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I've rather intentionally kept my friend count down under under 4,000. So
well, it's just a lot of posting and social media management,
which means I have plenty of room to add new friends right now.
Apparently, if you are on Facebook Live, you could see the drawing. So like our Facebook page, and you can watch the video and see the drawing of this. But apparently, my drawing looks like the blue waffle. And if you don't know what blue waffle is,
Google it.
Google blue waffle. Blue Waffle, your favorite local pancake house. So you don't know what it is?
No, I've got to try it.
Oh, boy, don't Google it. Shouldn't.
Should we do it right on
no,
air?
No, we shouldn't.
On air?
He is running for Congress.
That's right.
U.S.
Right.
Federal Congress.
You're right. We should
this is in a city council
different, race. Different kind of waffles.
Yeah.
Okay, let's move on.
So Drew joins us. Drew, you are a lawyer by trade?
I am.
So
26 years and
wow.
26 years sentence I've served now.
Yeah. I knew I'm
recovering, but not quite out of the cycle yet.
I met you in 2010, 2009?
Yeah. 2009, 2010, yeah.
You were thinking about running for Secretary of State, which is our ballot access race for the Libertarian Party of Indiana here. And it's our top race, and Drew was a guy that we were actively pursuing, and he just couldn't do it at the time, so now he is.
Well, I wasn't eligible, if you remember.
That's right.
Because I just moved back
here. Residency requirements.
Turns out that residency apparently does mean a lot to the Secretary of State, because that's why Charlie White got removed. So when he won.
Not for Senate. Senate, it doesn't matter at all.
It doesn't
seem to.
Nope.
Apparently not.
Yeah.
Evan Bayh returned to the race. And
Dan Coats.
Dan Coats, yeah. Evan Bayh, his neighbors have no idea that he lived there and have never seen him where he lives, but apparently he can, and that's why he might lose. So, we have an exciting show, not just because Drew is here, but because I am here and Greg is here, and that is exciting. And we are reading your comments on Facebook Live, so feel free to, if you're one of the hundreds watching at the moment or 11, then you can comment.
Let's ramp that up.
Right,
1100.
So we're going to talk a little bit about the hurricane that is actually coming to Florida. And on a personal note, if you are the praying type, please keep my grandparents in your prayers. They live in St. Augustine, Florida, on the beach. They're about a quarter of a mile from the ocean, and they're older, and they weren't able to actually evacuate. So
uh-oh.
They are riding it out, and the family's pretty worried. I'm worried. They are worried. So
what town do they live in?
St. Augustine Beach.
Okay.
So they'll be okay. It's just the week or two without power and no food. But we've got some family kind of ready to move down in that area. But please send up a prayer for my grandparents. But we have a hurricane. It's a Category 4. Hurricane Matthew. This is from the Weather Channel, weather.com. As of October 6th, 7:22 p.m., so you may be listening later, so it may have already hit, or it's maybe months later. But as of right now, we are looking at Hurricane Matthew, who is now a Category 4, hammering the northwest Bahamas. And it's hours away from beginning a potentially catastrophic rare Cat 4, perhaps even Cat 5, I didn't know that, siege on the Florida's east coast with dangerous storm surge. Destructive winds and flooding rainfall stretching into Georgia and South Carolina by the weekend. The eyewall may deliver the strongest, most destructive winds anyone in parts of the northeast and east central Florida coast have seen in their lifetime. The last and only Cat 4 hurricane to make landfall anywhere in northeast Florida or Georgia coast was in an 1898 hurricane of St. Simons Island, Georgia. According to the National Weather Service in Jacksonville, Florida, quote, some of the lowest barrier islands will be completely overtopped with large battering waves and life-threatening flooding.
Whoa.
Barrier islands are likely to be breached, and it is extremely possible that new inlets will be cut off in the worst affected areas. This will be, end quote, this will be a much greater storm surge than New Jersey saw during Superstorm Sandy. National Weather Service in Melbourne, Florida also pulled no punches regarding the potential impact, saying Matthew would likely be stronger than any hurricane in recent decades, including the 2004 hurricanes Charlie, Francis, Jeanne, as well as Hurricane David in 1979.
Oh, that was bad.
The severe impacts from this hurricane could lead to some locations being uninhabitable for weeks or months, the National Weather Service says. Hurricane warnings have been extended northward to South Santee River, South Carolina. This includes such locations as Orlando, Jacksonville, Florida, Savannah, Georgia, Charleston, South Carolina. A hurricane warning remains in effect along the entire east coast of Florida, as well as the northwest of the Bahamas. So the last time that a hurricane of any significance hit St. Augustine was in 1968. And then there was another hurricane a few years ago, because I remember my grandparents evacuating, and it was a Cat 2. And it did very little damage. I don't think they had any damage. This is obviously a hurricane of a different number. There's, as of now, about 110 people have died in Haiti. And this is going to be a significant hurricane. And one of the questions, the reason we're bringing this up is that, you know, we see natural disasters like this, and we see the government coordinating. The National Weather Service is the one feeding the information. That's a government agency. FEMA, the Division of Homeland Security, they are all feeding resources into this area and helping manage everything. So we realize that, you know, in the – sorry, the cat is creating her own natural disaster. The – you have natural disasters. You have real-life emergencies that take place. And the government coordinates. But in a libertarian society where we have as little of a state as possible, who coordinates? And so that is the question that we want to kind of talk about tonight, is in the course of these major disasters, what is the framework for solving problems like, you know, like my grandparents who can't leave? Who would I call? You know
what kind of, you know, because ultimately the Coast Guard can handle, will go into about virtually any situation where it's not an assured, you know, death or grounding by a helicopter.
Right. So one of the the Coast Guard's a great Coast example. Guard. Yeah. So Greg, why don't you start us off and kind of tell us, start at the beginning. I mean, in terms of predicting.
Well, I mean, I think it's one of the – it's tough. It's tough because our framework isn't necessarily well-suited to – there isn't something we can directly point to in this state. There isn't like an extraction services private company in the event of a mass casualty potentially or a situation from a hurricane. There isn't – you know, there could be multiple competing companies where it could be even part of your insurance plan, your homeowner's insurance plan in the event such a situation arises. These are the additional services you can purchase as a part of your policy, and you know, to provide extraction, to provide food and assistance, all these different things. The problem is how many the people that don't take advantage of it or don't add that onto their policy. That's the absence of a guarantee where government, even though it is theft, it is coercion and it's mandatory, there is the implicit guarantee of providing for those in a time of need, regardless of their ability to pay. And that's what appeals to a lot of people in times of crisis. Sure. Even though it's poorly done, like you see with the Superdome and during Katrina, you know, it took them 4 days to get water to New Orleans. Whereas, you know, the private organizations like Red Cross, they're on it immediately. They do this all the time. They're prepared for it. Whereas FEMA, a lot of times, is headed by a political appointee like Michael Brown, whose only background that I know of professionally was raising Arabian horses in the Middle East.
Brownie, you're doing a hell of a job.
Yeah, but then he was a bundler, and he gets appointed to FEMA, and you have Hurricane Katrina, and it becomes a hugely political issue.
Yeah, because the response in FEMA was poorly coordinated. You didn't have...
Red Cross leading it.
Right. As we've talked about in prior episodes, the notion of graft is alive and well in politics. When Mike Pence got elected, the outgoing Republican administration of Mitch Daniels, all of his people left, and all of Mike Pence's people were appointed. And we saw many different people who were campaign operatives or paid employees of his campaign get jobs that
required responsibility for administering services.
And they had just done some door knocking.
I mean, Kickback Kendall's the head of a pharmacy, and the guy.
The only drugs he's ever seen are in Broad Ripple on a Saturday night.
Yeah.
So
he can't even make his own meth. I don't want him in charge of the Department right. of Pharmacy.
How can he sort those pills with such small hands?
I know. How, and his board's so little, he can only do a few at a time.
So that's why we jokingly call him Kickback Kindle.
But no, that's the thing, is that ultimately you put people who are political operatives into positions of that require bureaucratic skill, and they're ill-prepared for it, and it's not like there's a corporate retreat program you can go to or an ongoing executive ed training to become good at delivering services well in a time of crisis.
Well, in a way, there is, right? I mean, they have all these leadership programs, whether you're in the Democratic Party or the Republican Party. They don't. That what they really teach you is about how to raise money and how to get people to the polls on election day. So they don't teach you much about administration. I think, you know, if you break this whole thing down in a serious way, I mean, what happens after a crisis like Katrina or Sandy? People in our country look to the government, they look to the president immediately, mm-hmm. and they say, okay, if George W. Bush is president, why aren't you in New Orleans the day after the crisis?
Why are you flying over it?
Exactly. If Obama is president, and I'm not trying to advocate for the Republicans, it's just the way the media treats the situation. If you're not statist enough, then you're going to be punished because of how you treat the situation. So in other words, when Chris Christie joins hands with Obama and they walk the shores and the damage of New Jersey, it's a positive outcome for both of them. But really, is it a positive outcome for the people? And here's the problem if you break this down. Okay, why do the people look to the government in the first place? Okay, it's as if there's a quasi-god that we've created out of government. How does government have the power to fix something that people don't? I mean, really, all the government is people working and money that comes in. That's all government is. So,
and
so,
the resources that only they are allowed. Like, you know, you could send an F-16 to a bunch of F-16s or a bomber, but a private citizen can't. You know, the Red Cross doesn't get a bomber.
Well, and that's a good point. And so when how does the government even have the money for disaster relief? So we're always dealing with the budget situation where what are we going to have to do because of disaster relief? Well, we're going to have to raise that debt ceiling, right? That innocuous
artificial.
Yeah, exactly. It's set and it could be moved. Why can it be moved at any time though? Because we have this creative monster called the Federal Reserve. Okay, if the only reason that the federal government can fund the solution to all these problems, or theoretically, because the federal government isn't a god. In fact, most of the people that rely on, a lot of people that rely so much on the government, don't believe there is any god of any kind. They want a humanist type of solution, and what they're looking to is a supplier of their needs. And the only way the government has to do this is through the issuance of additional currency, of additional money through the Federal Reserve.
Deficit financing.
Okay. So if that really works, if the government can issue more money and we can solve this problem, as if we could, get food to the people, get them up, get medical protection, rebuild their houses, then why not issue as much debt as possible, get it all fixed. Okay, and why does anybody have to pay a dime in taxes? Because it can all be done by the additional creation of money through a currency system. Well, it doesn't really work that way.
There are limits.
There are limits.
You approach hyperinflation at a point.
But
they
we've
just tried.
We've tread the line. But with Ben Bernanke, he did everything he could to push us into hyperinflation.
Reinflate the economy.
Right. Instead, we're almost in a deflationary situation. So if the Fed does, here's my thought. To push it to the end of my thinking. If the government isn't going to solve the problem, if the money isn't going to do it, because it's not, because all we're going to do is create a situation where somebody's going to pay it back. We're not going to pay it back by financing more. The Chinese, the Russians aren't going to pay it back for us. We're not going to raise enough taxes to pay it back.
No, that would create a depression.
Right. Ultimately, what we have are the people that are behind it in the first place. So this is a challenge, I think, for if in a libertarian and a true libertarian. This is a challenge I've thought for my libertarian friends all along the way. When I decided to run for office, Why can't we solve this problem? Why can't we do everything that government can without the government doing it for us?
And I think we do in a lot of ways.
Well, we
do. The Salvation Army and these organizations.
But do we? Can't we step up and do more? Yes.
And so the expectation isn't there because I pay taxes.
Exactly. So what if we get out ahead of this problem and tell the government, we don't want your money, we don't need it. Let's go. Let's form our own Red Cross. Let's form our own Libertarian Army, and let's go down and drop sandbags, deliver groceries, get
with the Liberty Chicken on it,
whatever it takes.
But that largely happened with
Katrina.
Totally, that largely happened with Katrina.
Well, they're not hamstrung by all the regulations, and then you know the
church buses
of command.
Filled with high school kids going from Traverse City, Michigan, because I was there when they were.
Wasn't it Jonestown or not Jonestown? That was a completely different disaster
of a different kind.
Joplin, Missouri. Wasn't it Joplin,
the
Missouri?
Tornado.
Where they basically like told the feds get out.
And that was yeah.
They weren't
helping.
Yeah, so basically the feds were getting in the way, so some rednecks got their trucks and their guns.
Oath keepers, Chris.
And went and said, you get out, don't come in these city limits, we will take care of it. And they did a perfectly fine job.
Well, that's what ultimately ends up happening, is the people closest to it have the concentration of knowledge, and they're really the information hub on how to coordinate and handle it anyway.
Right.
They know the neighbors. They know the people who are trapped in their homes. You know, the National Guard is, what are they going to do? Go around with a checklist, knocking door to door in the midst of the aftermath of a tornado or during Hurricane Matthew? That's crazy.
No, they're going to shoot the zombies that are coming out to hurt other people. Right.
Right?
That's what they're trained to do.
Yeah.
They break things and kill people.
Right. And instill law and order.
And they've got guns handy to do that.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that that's not necessary following a disaster to some extent.
Yeah, there's going
to
be looting.
That's right.
You know, just like in Charlotte or anytime there's a disaster.
Yeah.
People are going to exploit it.
So that's a necessary piece of the solution, but it's not the solution by any means at all, because the National Guard is not going to be bandaging wounds.
They don't do this.
That's not what they're there for.
No, they do this for the college tuition assistance,
and the government is not equipped to predict when a disaster is coming or how to handle it. So whatever we do in the aftermath of this, all the government is going to be doing is adding to a debt that somehow we got to figure out the algebra that says we can repay
that. Now that is beneficial. But for, let's say you have, you, like you live in a flood area and you have to have where FEMA's dignified, it's one of their floodplain areas.
Sure.
And then you get the insurance. They provide you with the money to rebuild your house if your insurance company's giving you hell over, well, you didn't put hurricane, you only put tsunami in your policy.
Right.
You know, this doesn't actually cover, it's, we stop at stage three. We don't go over stage four hurricanes.
But isn't, that's partly due to government. The problem with insurance is that
it's totally administered by the government.
Right. They issue all of the laws and they regulate it to help protect people and
consumer advocacy.
Yeah, and it ends up creating all these different loopholes, and so people who play loopholes, people like Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, make off like a bandit, while people like Gary Johnson and Jill Stein are just sitting on the sidelines.
Will somebody let us talk?
Feeling sad. I'm using that as an illustrative point. I mean, there's an establishment, and when the government outlines what you can and can't have in private insurance, then you get things like in Katrina, where almost every insurance policy after Katrina was a huge scandal. Almost every insurance company said your homeowner's insurance will not cover this because it was damaged by floods. It was not damaged by the hurricane.
Right.
Well, the hurricane caused the floods.
Yeah.
No.
That's like saying your house burnt down because of the match, not because of the fire that came after it.
They said, no, it was the federal government that caused the flood. It was.
That's right.
It was gay marriage. It's always gay marriage.
Listen, I don't want to say that this is a punishment, but.
But on the other hand, if you think about it carefully.
Drew, thoughts on punishment for gay marriage? Matthew, go ahead. No, I'm just kidding. We just
no controversial statements while running for Congress.
No, I can make controversial statements.
Well, it isn't even controversial because it's satire. That there is a large segment of one of the major parties right now that would believe such logic.
Absolutely.
After seeing the dozens of posts on Facebook that suggest that, among disasters of many other kinds that have been caused by our sin. And
God hates the gays so much he's going to just take out everybody.
No, God hates us, so he sent Donald Trump to be president. So,
well, that's God hates us, so he sent Donald Trump to cure all of our ills. Right.
Maybe he's a prophet. Maybe you're right.
What? There's only one way to tell.
If he's a prophet, give me the hat.
There's only one way to tell, and it is
elect him.
Oh, well, I don't know. If he's a prophet,
we gotta we have to pass it to find out what's in it, Drew.
Well, there's that possibility.
No. Isn't it interesting, though, that after Katrina, the government, who everyone looked to, failed miserably.
Miserably.
The Red Cross did what they always do and filled in the gaps and did it immediately without any of the restrictions. Like, what's going on right now is they're moving all the food and supplies in preparation to Fort Bragg in Albany.
Beautiful.
And,
yeah. And it's school buses there, from South Carolina are heading to the coast.
Yeah, but, the government's moving resources to the military bases where they're going to sit and then wait. And right. Then there's going to be a chain of command, and it could be stalled up because somebody didn't follow a chain of command, or there's a esoteric regulation surrounding the delivery of good and service. Who has authority? People just sitting there. Everyone's waiting to be extracted. Well, we're not sure who actually has the authority to go save them.
Yeah. Well, and I'm going to be agnostic on the Red Cross because I'm old enough to remember Elizabeth Dole bailing out fraud and misuse of funds the Red Cross. Across 25 years ago. The thing is that there are so many. It's like that disruptive economy. One of my favorite things about, if I was going to pick out my favorite things of Gary Johnson's candidacy for president, and granted, we have moments where we have less favorite things, but if I was going to pick out some of his favorite things, to say that he wants to end the imperial presidency, that's a powerful statement to me. Yeah. It's been way too long.
Not since Washington.
It's true. And the other thing is when it comes to the disruptions to the economy through Uber, Airbnb, we were talking about Bitcoin before we went live, the opportunities for charities to step up. And unfortunately, the Red Cross, I think, would be so much more effective. And it is effective. It's powerful and it's important because it's mostly made up of volunteers. And that's why. But the Red Cross would probably be much more effective, I think, if it took out all of the layers of government regulation to maintain its nonprofit status. Yeah. So there are a number of entities. And I challenge people tonight to start looking for what are the resources to find the most efficient ways to get things to people that they need, whether it's toilet paper, medical care, helping people like your grandparents get to safe places.
Or social networks like Nextdoor, the neighborhood social network.
Absolutely. That's powerful.
That is way more powerful. And there's no government Nextdoor.
Never has been and never will be.
There's no communication medium the government has that allows them to, even 911 won't work. But it'll still work over Wi-Fi and cellular lines. And the government has no such system.
I think for libertarians, one thing that seems enormous to me as a proposition for going forward, even after this election, is instead of trying to directly take on the government, just be anti-government, let's make the government irrelevant.
Replace it with our solution.
That's right. We've got so many opportunities to do that today, unlike any time in the past.
That's been Greg's main criticism of Gary Johnson, and I don't disagree.
It drives me crazy.
Is that I'm listening to his interview, an in-depth interview with a friendly libertarian podcast, two libertarian journalists, and Matt Welch of Reason and Kamele Foster. They formerly did the show The Independents together. They both support Gary Johnson. They're asking about his foreign policy, and he just didn't seem to have any answer other than I'm being attacked.
It's curiosity. Intellectual curiosity that there is a rest of the world.
Right. And so what Gary Johnson said basically is that, non-interventionism is the way to go. And we cause all these problems. And I don't disagree with anything that he's saying in terms of he's right.
Oh, completely.
Non-interventionist foreign policy is the right way to go. Interventionist foreign policy and neocon ideas are what led to the rise of ISIS and led us into...
created Saddam, we deposed, and then created ISIS.
A state of perpetual warfare. You know, it's what Dwight Eisenhower warned against. But...
what do you do in...
sitting in the Oval Office, you can't just say, well, everything we've done is bad.
We're going to not intervene.
Right.
Or when your phone rings, you're not going to know who you're about to speak to.
That's the real issue, is the lack of knowledge about the bureaucracy, because it would be... that was my contention, is that if Gary were to win, and you put him in there, he has no staff, because he hasn't even begun thinking about who he'd put in his cabinet. If something... you would have a scandal on day one because something would get missed. Mm-hmm. That's the problem. And then libertarianism is set so far back because it looks like amateur hour. Like, we haven't begun believing – we don't believe we're going to win. And until we start doing that, we're going to act the part. And when we start acting the part, we're going to have plans and alternatives that are viable in voters' minds. And they're going to say, you know what? That sounds good. We're going to go with it. I'm tired of the same old, same old.
Do you think the answer, though, is continuing to pursue a path? I mean, you know, I felt that it's not the best strategy, and you've been the former executive director of the state party, Chris. Mm-hmm. I've never felt, candidly, and all the libertarians out there hear me say this, they can come shoot me afterwards if they want to, but that I never felt that it was the best strategy to focus solely, strictly, with a lot of total emphasis on local races, and here's why. If we have some success, and Rex Bell has had tremendous success, and not just Rex, but the whole eastern swath of the state of Indiana has done very well in local races. It's impressive, it's exciting, and we owe a great debt of gratitude to all the people that have participated in that. On the other hand, we got to go beyond that.
I'm the total opposite. I would only, like, because messaging is at the top.
It is, but the top, you're right. The problem is, though, one of our messages should be about the imperial presidency. And, folks, get your mind off of who's going to be elected president. Think more about who's going to be elected to Congress. Think about governor's races, Senate races. You know, think about those high level. Who cares about who's elected attorney general in the state of Indiana? But you know what? If you look at the attorney generals across the 50 states, they have as much impact on things that affect policy as anybody else. And who can name their attorney general in their state?
Right.
And I mean, frankly, I refuse to run for that office because if you're going to get ignored, you are nothing but part of a ticket.
If the big guys are going to get ignored, the third party's going to get ignored. Even, I mean, you're shouting in the wilderness.
Yeah. It's and that's one thing that Johnson talked about, is that we do, you know, and the libertarian side, if you are a Libertarian Party person, you need to think about running for office, because – said, as I travel the country, there aren't that many people running, more people running in 2016 than there were in 2012, you know. And he basically said that in 2020, that's the goal. The goal is not to have a stellar top-of-ticket candidate, although you want that. It's to have up-and-down-the-ballot races.
Agreed.
But to do that, you've got to be an educated person. You know, I trust you going to Congress. I know you know your stuff.
Do the job.
Not only are you, you know, it, and it's not, and this is the argument that Greg and I make to libertarians, is that here's my problem with a lot of libertarians, and I know we veered off of the
we'll get back to it though,
the hurricane, but I think that this is important.
It all ties in.
Yes, you do. You should read a lot of Rothbard. You should know a lot about economic basics. Yes, you should be philosophically grounded, because that is what keeps you philosophically grounded. But you cannot ignore the fact that we live in an incredibly statist society.
Right.
And the people that you are talking to aren't going to accept no as an answer. They want to hear no, but they want to hear the change.
Here's how we do it.
And so when you get to Congress, people expect you to write legislation.
And Drew already has.
Yeah, and so people expect a politician to have political answers. And it's not too much to ask that if somebody runs as a libertarian, I don't want you to just have the same philosophy as me. I want you to have plans on how you're going to achieve our political philosophy. It is literally like trying to leave on a trip and taking no roadmap. We have no roadmap, and that's you know, we aren't necessarily...
It's like a startup. We're going to get there and figure out what our model is once we're there.
We aren't always popular in the ANCAP circle just because we don't sit here and mentally masturbate about ANCAP societies.
Yeah.
That we try to apply libertarian philosophy to the politics of today.
And what's actually achievable.
And
that's the key.
That's what libertarian politicians should do. Instead of, like, I'm not a politician, I'm above all... No, you're a politician. Own it. Craft political strategies.
Right.
Craft political strategies both through government and in politics to win.
Right.
That's what we're here to do. We're here to win. Drew is running for office.
And we can't. That's the thing, is we've just avoided it and stopped thinking we can't. For some reason, we never start with the assumption we're going to win.
Right.
And we're going to prepare like it.
That's because this is an incredibly passive movement. It is a lot
the party of passive aggression.
You know,
that's why I got in trouble for
passive
that
this aggression.
Week. I used to call it the party of passive aggression.
Well, you know, we should be hyper. Well, and it's fair to say that the smaller the race, the greater the likelihood, the greater the opportunity to win. It's easier to convert that base. Look, one of the lessons that I've learned in running this race.
And let me say, local government is one of the few places where confidence in the government has not eroded.
True.
So. Sorry to cut you off.
Well, no, that's fine. Unfortunately, in most places, though, that's still with one or both of the two statist parties running the show, and libertarians haven't participated enough in local government, and that's a big key, is that we have to be able to articulate a message that is workable. I really like what you said, Greg, and I understand. If you're thinking about sort of a utopian libertarian world, okay, if that isn't ever achievable, it's out there a couple hundred years. All of us at this table are long dead,
yeah. You
know. So how do we get there? Yeah. You know, what I'd like to do is start building the bridge. We're never going to have a bridge if we don't start laying the first foundation. Now, I picked an incredibly difficult race, too, Chris. Yeah. I'm going to have to admit that. It's, you know,
but yes, you did. Gerrymandering makes it very difficult.
Exactly.
And if you are a libertarian, you should be running for Secretary of State, and you should be running for State House.
I disagree.
And
I'll tell you
why. I'll say this.
Okay.
Here's the first place we ought to start.
The State House is an important place.
It
I agree.
Is, it is
very important. Tantamount.
Running to reform election laws.
But don't that's true. But don't forget that all of those districts are well gerrymandered too.
Absolutely.
Perhaps even more so.
Yeah. But fight starts there.
Put pressure and never let that pressure up on those people.
But you know, if we're going to elect people that I don't care if they're president. I mean, we don't really elect a king because they only got 8 years. Even Obama's going to leave. Even Clinton left.
He got like one thing done. And it may not even be financially viable. Bill Clinton's trashing it.
That's right. That's fascinating.
You know what I mean?
I thought you guys were going to ask me, what law would you repeal if you were actually elected?
See, that's the problem. Is that's what everyone leaves with. Is all this? I'm going to go in and we're going to repeal it. Well, that's great, but then you just become obstructionist and you lose the midterm because you sit around and don't do anything.
Maybe, but
you're on the defense all the time.
The Republicans won back Congress in a midterm election. Because Obamacare had just passed without a single Republican vote, mm-hmm. And that's when they looked the strongest, is when they came in to oppose Obamacare. Now, on the other hand, when you go in, it's true that the voters, the overall message might be fix it, don't end it sort of thing, but I'm not really sure about that. What I would say, though, carrying on the other point about running for Secretary of State, running for local, absolutely run for local legislative offices, run for Secretary. They are the most important. But if we don't position candidates running for Congress so that we can be an influence in Congress. I mean, I started a business 2 years ago called Tinker Street Funding, and it was designed to.
Is it angel capital or venture funding?
Equity crowdfunding. Title
III. So it's crowdsourcing?
Yeah, crowdsourcing.
That's what your lobbying was for.
Exactly. And miserable failure. Why? Because nobody in Congress knows anything about crowdfunding. They don't know what Title III of the Jobs Act is. They could barely even spell the jobs. I shouldn't go that far. But they don't know what the acronym stands for the most part.
Right.
It would be hard-pressed. There's one congressman, Patrick McHenry from North Carolina, who's a potent leader on that particular issue. The rest of Congress is miles behind him. Now, that said, look, I think this is an opportunity, and I don't care. I would say this to my other 9 colleagues who are running for congressional office here. influence your congressman. You can make a difference. And
annoy the shit out of them.
Annoy them.
That's right.
And be the, you know, get close to them. Whatever it takes. If it takes being their friend, look, they're going to pay attention to you when you're there, when they have to listen to you. And that's the starting point for us. And then you can be the mouthpiece to tell them that either you're going to have to change or ultimately you're going to lose, because every candidate has some Achilles heel. Mm. And it will come to light, and be the person that brings that to light. I think it's really important that we focus on these kind of mid-level races, because we're not going to affect real change in America if we don't change the way Congress and state legislatures are configured.
And certain levels of – like there's almost a litmus test of at a certain level you finally get some press. You know, when you're running in the races that just are not covered ever, and so the way government's set up now where it's so centrally planned, a libertarian getting elected to city council is so hamstrung by all the other regulations heaped down on top of them.
True.
It's – really marginal whether you make a difference or not, but right. You get them in the in Congress or in the state level state house, that's great. But because that's kind of to me the litmus test, and that should be where everything's focused. That's our minimum bar and up.
What we have to, and my point about running for state house is not that you're going to get elected and that you're going to change the maps.
Oh, I hope we
and
will,
and I do too. But I'm saying that as a libertarian, 60%, 65% of the state house candidates here in Indiana. For state senator, state house, they don't have a challenger because they've given themselves that gift, and so you are the alternative, and you are the one forcing them to have debates. You're the one that is forcing them to interview for their job, and
see, like I would even say, rather than do that, we should have an entire election cycle where all we focus on is slandering people with scandal. Well, like then, find the ones that don't have opponents that run unopposed. And just pour resource, like every resource we have, try to dig up dirt run singularly on them being a bad person.
Well, so let me lay this out, because
like Andre Carson that you're running against.
I've been thinking a lot about this lately, and
that's your job, not mine.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that, I mean, yes, the team around the candidate, the actual candidate.
That is one of the reasons that we started this podcast, is so that we have the ability to. We just don't have.
And you guys are good at it.
Pair apart, yeah.
No, well, really.
We win.
That's right.
We win.
Oh, God.
So we are building a movement. And what you have to understand is that we are not building a party. We are not building a political ideology. We are building a movement. And a movement demands that you not only have the philosophical end, but you also have the political action. In the inside politics, but then the outside activism, you have people who are crafting legislation, you have people who are doing media, you have all these different components where people work together. We are the largest group of independent voters. That means that we are the most powerful force in American politics as libertarians.
That's being silenced.
That is being silenced because we choose to sit down and be silenced. We are the people who sit and we accept half-assed candidates because we aren't willing to do the work. We don't run for office because we are too afraid, because we think the job is too hard. None of that's true. The truth is that we buy into memes. And I don't mean the memes that Greg loves. I'm talking about broad social ideas. And this is really where we're heading as a society. We are heading Look at the development of the meme that Gary Johnson is an idiot, moron, doofus.
Correct.
Now,
live by the meme, die by the meme.
Right. You're branded instantly, and you don't control it.
Right. And so you have to develop systems.
You guys got to make me the subject of a meme or two before this.
Yeah.
Well.
And I hope it's a good one.
Yeah.
But see, good ones don't work as well.
I like Harambe. Gary Johnson is Harambe.
Yeah.
Even though I'm not included in the debates, so I'm still watching over you.
That's why Donald Trump is so effective as a candidate. He can do the exact opposite of everything that works. Do you understand? Like, I am a creature of a political system, okay? I am a creature of old political thought. I was trained by Abdul to think like an established establishment person.
Organize, canvas.
Yes.
Coordinate.
TV lasts a short time. Yard signs are worth 7 votes apiece or whatever. All that bull crap.
You have to pay your dues.
And that is why at every point through this election cycle, you have heard me say, well, it's never going to work. Because I have had the belief that there are stop gaps in the system, that at some point adults will step up. But the fact is there aren't adults.
True.
There aren't adults that are going to say
fewer and fewer
that this person talking about the size of his penis in a debate, this person calling his opponent Crooked Hillary.
Well, she is crooked, though.
These, of course, but these rules of decorum that we expect from candidates.
Being presidential.
Tim right. Kaine demonstrated why that can hurt you.
Absolutely.
If you're anybody but Donald Trump.
Right. And
but Donald Trump had two things, if I may interrupt you just briefly. He had two things. One. Okay, I've got a field of 16 politicians, okay? I've got a lot of money, a lot of celebrity status, a lot of name recognition. I'm the only non-politician. And I've had my voice heard in the political circles for a long time.
He focus-tested his message early at CPAC before.
Well, 1 out of 17. I'm going to stand out in this crowd. I don't care what else is going on. You know, it's going to be narrowed down. The only way to beat me is to get it down to it. And the Republicans do that, to get it down to a two-man race. So then you get Rubio, Kasich, and Cruz fighting against each other.
Getting behind Cruz early killed. That dictated what, you know, the way that they outcome the election.
And then he gets this gift of Hillary Clinton in the general election. And I do think it's a gift.
Oh,
because
that's great.
Nobody is going to be who's going to get out of bed early on election day to go vote for Hillary? I don't know
she anyone. She can't even get out of bed.
She can't even get out of bed herself.
No. So, how's she going to vote?
But then who else can get excited about her? I mean, I fear, you know, for the next generation. I have 3 daughters, and I truly feel that with Hillary Clinton, I'm certainly not making an endorsement for Trump in any way, but I'm my vote's with my party and Gary Johnson 100%. But, you know, Hillary Clinton, I believe, rather than advancing the cause of feminism in America, will set it back almost a generation if she's elected.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she's a disaster in that way. But anyway, so I think that Hillary is a real gift to Trump, and that's what makes this election a real race.
A lot of lifelong politicos hate it that he hacked the system.
Yeah, because he
made it. Why is he exempt from the rule? Why is he right. The exception and the anomaly? Because he didn't even – he spent – other than, I think, what, Rand Paul and then the people in the JV debate, he spent the least amount of money. And then cost-effective, the least amount per vote.
Because the rule has always been is that you use the more money you spend, the more likely you're going to win.
And people hate the exception.
But you know, if the Trump rules...
She's saying that, why am I not 40 points? I've spent $900 million, and he spent $300 million.
I'm spending $10 million on the Libertarian, damn it.
Because it's $50 million, he's spending $10. But that's the point, is that, you know, it bothers all these journalists and these campaign consultants because all these journalists get paid by the political ads. And so if the whole system is upside down where spending money doesn't actually mean that you win, holy shit.
Well, when you can still get media without spending anything.
Exactly right.
But, you know, I had this conversation with a Libertarian candidate in Michigan just about the money that you spend trying to be the candidate who gets the most votes per dollar spent.
Right.
And the truth is, if the Trump rules could work for everybody, you know, Tiffany Hayden would beat John Conyers this year and
right.
get elected to Congress because she kind of follows those rules, and she's a lot better looking, and she's...
Yes.
But you
yes,
have to play like him. That's the thing.
Well,
a lot
I don't
of people
think,
aren't
I don't
willing
think playing
to
like him
lose
is
the
all,
decorum.
Well, the decorum... There are places to throw it away and there are places to keep it. If you're insulting someone on the other side, that's there still needs to be decorum.
Like saying that Andre Carson eats cats or that he joined ISIS. See, he's uncomfortable with it.
Oh, yeah, because
like,
you
don't have what it takes to win, Drew Thompson.
Oh, well, no,
I remember I wrote an ad for Carlos May that was putting Carlos May was a Republican opponent that ran against him and was putting Bin Laden and Carson on a billboard that said Brothers in Faith.
You know what? If you want to talk about Andre Carson, let's talk about Andre Carson. 4th least effective congressman in the United States House of Representatives.
Child and his family.
What right. what has he accomplished since he has not had one bill passed, very few introduced that have made it to the floor. I don't think he's had any bills that have made it to the floor of Congress. Yet he sits on the Intelligence Committee at the behest of
which
Nancy.
Which is hilarious.
What's not only hilarious, it's a little bit scary. If you watch his YouTube videos and some of the dialogue that he's had with more extreme elements of, you know, a community that could pose a threat to national security, it's what is it? What are the secrets that he has divulged? What kind of private servers does he have access to? You know, these are good questions. But most important to me is, where does he get his money? That's the killer. I mean, the corruption.
It's unbelievable.
It is unbelievable. Large banks, labor unions.
Bank of America.
Bank of America is one of his big
defense
donors.
Contractor Raytheon's a huge one. I mean, it's just like
It's a who's who of corporate corruption.
Yeah.
If you're against crony capitalism, then you're against a lot of our incumbents. And while I've met Andre Carson, I've had dialogue with him. I like him personally. I truly do. If you're against crony capitalism, retire him, bring him home, send somebody else to Congress.
Let's talk about the biggest opponent of Citizens United, Hillary Clinton.
Right.
Having a PAC spend $50 million on her behalf. To destroy a third-party candidate who has, let's be frank, no chance of winning at this point.
8% in the polls right now.
8%. And
it's because six of those, that eight, are coming from Democrats that are disillusioned, or 4%.
She's going to spend $1 billion on this election.
The president saying, on September 28th, he says a vote for Gary Johnson is a vote for Trump.
Right.
Or a third-party candidate. And you're like, that's the biggest endorsement you could possibly... You know, that's the announcement of a threat.
That's right. That's true. And I like that. I mean, we should tout that, I think, going forward.
Yeah, this PAC that is attacking Gary Johnson that was in the New York Times is solely funded by George Soros and the people in his fundraising network. That is a guy who not to go into Glenn Beckland, but Glenn Beck isn't wrong. If you look at DC leaks, you start seeing this guy is a major funder of all. He's the Cokes of the left. And the reason I think he's a boogeyman is because he disagrees with me on everything.
He's an Austrian financier that became a billionaire because he bet and pounded away at the British pound until they had to actually revalue their currency.
He damn near collapsed the British currency.
He just kept shorting it and shorting it and shorting it until they actually had to go ahead and do a revaluation.
For his own personal gain.
And then he became a billionaire. And that's not, shows you his mindset.
Well, and the whole discussion on issues like climate change would look radically different if it wasn't for George Soros.
Al Gore would never be worth millions and millions of dollars were it not for George Soros.
That's not an endorsement of George Soros by any means. And it's not a challenge to the climate change machinery. It's just a fact that the reality is that if it wasn't for millions and millions and millions of dollars that George Soros had thrown into the political arena – trying to elect, and this is the problem I have with the Green Party. It says it's so much about environmental issues. That's why it's the Green Party, right?
Kumbaya Party.
I guess.
Yeah.
But the reality is it's more about socialism than it is about
communalism with guilds instead of government.
So if our answer to everything is to solve problems through government, then it really doesn't matter what the problem is, problem that you have to depend on the government to solve. And that's what I think George Soros does.
Yeah.
And that's why Hillary Clinton's his candidate, and that's why he's the darling child of the left.
James Neese commented, Soros, like, bake the fucking euro.
Bake the euro. I love it.
He is something else, this kid.
He did. He made his money forcing a government to submit to his will. And if that doesn't tell you anything about the way he views himself in politics globally,
and American crazy policy as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. This guy is, and he's an Austrian financier, one of the early hedge, like the Gordon Gekko of that era.
And that is the problem
true.
With Democrats.
Exactly true.
Is the Democrats come out and they preach against all this.
Wall Street donates to the Democrats way more than the Republicans.
Way more, because they love big government.
Big government takes care of big business.
Democrats are primarily Jewish.
This just fell out. What does this look like to you?
The Rorschach test.
Yeah.
Oh my God!
Everyone has to take it.
See, that's an elephant spraying water.
Is that what that is?
Yeah, that's an elephant.
It's an abstract.
You got that from the Bob and Tom show, didn't you?
No, I drew that during a Creating Maya episode.
Well, that's what I think is going to be interesting though. So Hurricane Matthew hits. Right. We're looking at mass devastation, probably. There's going to be human interest story after human interest story for the next year. And it's going to become politicized because it's Florida. It's a swing state. And the way the response is handled by the existing administration poses a significant risk to Hillary Clinton. Because if this thing's bungled at all, it is a heyday for Donald Trump to just hammer away.
Well, I can't wait for Bill Clinton to be down there 2 weeks after the hurricane. I mean, I can't wait for anything. The only thing I can't wait is for the hurricane to be over and people to get relief. But I think it will be quite interesting when Bill Clinton is down there saying the craziest thing in the world isn't the way that the formulas for Obamacare now. Instead, the craziest thing in the world is how we're trying to deal with the aftermath of Hurricane
Matthew.
Our
October surprise is a hurricane.
Boy, and it's not funny.
No,
but it's real.
What it is.
It is what it is.
Because how this is handled will dictate the election.
And I got to tell you that the statist answers to it are not answers that are going to ever be satisfactory. And I don't care how you spin it. The media can put a happy face on it, but people are going to suffer immensely. And the only relief for that is other people lending their hands and arms. And
when I heard this, I immediately in my mind visualized a fleet of Trump jets down there for private relief, like for people to get in and be.
Well, you know,
if I were his campaign manager, I would be down there with the Trump water.
Yep.
Everything waiting, and then they come get on the jet. We'll take you wherever you want to go.
And it doesn't matter if it looks like plain pandering because he gets away with whatever he wants to.
Yep. Well, and it's not even that. I mean, if it's plain pandering, if that's exactly what it is, and from Donald Trump, I would frankly expect no less. He's a politician, and he really is a politician. You know what? If you're helping people and you're going to make a difference, and he's got the wherewithal to do it, and you know, and that's what he saved all his money for all those years by not paying income tax, by gaming the system in a legal way, then by all means, help people in Florida now. Now's your opportunity to shine.
It eliminates the wealth problem and like the existing outside and the tax, you know, and I just thought, man, that could be something. If he has a fleet of the Trump jets ready to go to, you know, fly people out.
But Donald, please put your money where your mouth is, and everybody else in America, put what you can where you can.
That's sort of the point. I mean, if you look back at the myths of the robber baron era, you look at the robber baron era from Reconstruction up until the progressives, and then in the early 1900s, that period when people like Andrew Carnegie who had immense Catholic faith, who to some extent felt guilty about the wealth that they had, donated massive amounts of their wealth. The Vanderbilts,
they funded the arts and cultural, you know, centers of the country.
The Rothschilds.
Yeah.
Oh, now I really made they you know,
Nazi gold.
Yeah.
The Mellons.
The Carnegie Mellon
Ford
Library Ford.
Henry Ford.
Yeah, I mean, these people did a tremendous amount of good, just like Mark Zuckerberg. He's pledged billions and billions of dollars. He's going to give away all of his Bill and Melinda Gates.
Right.
These people who make immense amounts of money, they do good with their wealth. And
they do.
And
they
then look
do.
At the Clintons.
On the other hand, though, what you have to remember about that era 100 years ago, look, if it hadn't been for that same group of people, some of whom were on Jekyll Island in 1910 when they conceived the Federal Reserve, we wouldn't have the statist kind of society that we have today. So it's true that there was an enormous philanthropic underpinnings in their families and in many things that they did. But at the same time, you can select people out of that group who decided that they were going to take part in increasing the power of the state over the people. David Starr Jordan was the president of Indiana University at the turn of the 20th century, the end of the 19th. And David Starr Jordan's idea about forming the best school of education in the United States was that children should be pounded out like nails.
Yeah, the Soviet model of education.
Yep.
Right. And you know, and I go with the John Taylor Gatto model.
Yep.
Question everything.
Yep.
You know, look at life.
Decentralization.
Why we need to end the Department of Education is not because of all the money it spends and not even.
No, it's because after we created it, we've gone down every year since it's been in existence.
Well, because truly it isn't a Department of Education. It's a Department of programming the next generation to be loyal to the state that they serve.
It's a command and control center.
And I mean, now I feel like here we are and we are libertarians. That sounds like a pretty mainstream comment. But to the rest of the world, that's out there.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Well, and they don't realize that since it was created, that we were number one. So it was a solution to not a problem.
That's true.
And now it became we're between Albania and Slovenia and like math scores. And we literally have not gotten back to where we were since its inception.
Yeah.
And we're not headed in that direction, no matter how many tests.
Yeah, like the Great Society was created by Johnson, and the poverty rate has remained the exact same.
So the statist answers, I mean, my reason for running is to say, look, these answers the government supplies don't solve problems.
They're just expensive.
And you know, if it's not a good enough answer to the people who vote and who want something from government that to say no, you're not going to have that anymore – then let's lead by example, and that's what I say. I mean, you know, this is a huge opportunity. If Donald Trump wants to fly planes down there, please do.
Yeah,
you know, I hope he's listening.
Critics be damned. You know what I mean?
I know that Donald listens every week to We Are Libertarians.
He listens to Rob Kendall, who called him very, very wonderful.
He did. And Rob reminds us on an hourly daily basis that. He has interviewed both Donald Trump.
Has the best interviews.
Has the best.
Chris Spangle has no interviews. Sad.
I have apparently no talent.
Time out. Who's here tonight?
Yeah,
that's exactly right.
Yep. And yeah. This is way better than the Rob or Central Indiana Today, isn't it?
Hey, I'm not going there.
We have a bigger board.
I am a politician.
Yeah.
I want you to lean.
He's
over
not
here.
Your district. You're fine.
Lean over here. Look at the size of this board. Look.
That is impressive.
Isn't it? Isn't it?
That
You've been
impressive.
On Central Indiana today. How little is his board? It's very little, isn't it?
I'm not talking about the size of anyone's hands. I'm not talking about the size of their board either.
You know what they say about a small board? Small listenership.
Small listenership. So
small.
He's just jealous of our success and our looks.
No. But and
my good friend Rob Kendall.
Yeah, great guy. Kickback Kendall.
My good friend Abdul Hakim Shabazz.
It's like Adam Carolla says, listen, the more dears you add to your friend, the less you like them. My dear friend Greg Lenz.
It's like in the Senate, you know, the great senator assholes from North Carolina, you know. You can just smell it while they're going on and on. It's almost a tradition.
It happens.
It does.
It does.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting though, because you know, there isn't a great libertarian answer yet. We got to get. That's the thing, is we have to fill in these gaps.
I disagree. I think there is a great libertarian answer. I think if we understand that the answer is humanity, charity, and working for what we believe in, putting our money where our mouth is, putting our feet where, you know, they can be useful to sort of stand in the gap. You know, we can make a difference.
But it's not a guarantee.
It's never.
And that's
a guarantee.
What people want in crisis.
Yeah,
but people
look
at government.
That's what people. Some people are actually on the beaches. I've lived through three hurricanes. The first one was Hurricane Alicia that came through Galveston.
Corpus Christi?
It might have been Galveston, actually, and Houston in 1983. And when that hurricane hit, there were people surfing, you know, on the beach on the Gulf Coast. And they never got chances to surf down there because they don't get that same
waves.
Kind of tide. Yeah. So they looked at it as the opportunity of a lifetime. Hell yeah, there's risk. There's always risk, no matter what we do. And so you know what? If it doesn't work out, it doesn't work out. Try the next thing. I mean, that's why we have Uber. That's
have you seen Tommy Boy?
I haven't.
So Tommy Boy, they're
apparently I need to.
So Chris Farley and David Spade are trying to sell brake pads.
Well, then if I haven't seen a Chris Farley movie, I got
to
see it.
Okay, so they're trying to sell brake pads and break into new markets to keep the factory alive and keep the business going.
Right.
And so they go in and they try to sell a supplier, in a, I think it's a supplier, on their brake pads, but he doesn't want to because the competitor has the guarantee on the box. And it's the idea that even though that's a BS guarantee, no one, how many people actually take care of it?
Exactly.
It's just the theoretical existence that in the event you need it makes people feel so much safer. That's the idea of the safety net. And that's the hard part for libertarians is if we can't point to the concrete alternative that may be voluntary, even if it's privately administered, that it's there and it can handle an influx of people.
Well, how do you defend if you're Todd Young or somebody else and you get attacked on Social Security? How do you defend against the charge that Social Security is a Ponzi scheme? You know, what do you say to that? Actually,
what do you say that Social Security is a Ponzi scheme?
I mean, in essence,
because you're guaranteed to get your money back because we can print our own dollars, whereas a Ponzi scheme. Once one card pulls out, the people that are last in don't get anything.
But that's based on the belief that we can always print our own dollars.
Well, so far we've got they may not be worth anything, but we can always print them.
True. Okay.
Or so, digitally create them.
So you're gonna get dollars that are worth a lot less than what you put in, perhaps.
Right. That's, we are for sure. You know that.
But that's a risk. That's a risk.
It is.
And that. Okay. So technically, it isn't a Ponzi scheme. But what it becomes then is the sort of pyramid type of scandal that is financed by this printing of money
by a guarantee.
By a theoretical guarantee, all the guarantee is a number. It's not anything of value.
Yeah, because you might need $1 trillion monthly, and you only get 2,000.
If you're banking on Social Security in any way, if you're banking on the government guarantee,
which everybody is, I mean, that's the majority of Americans' retirement plan.
True enough, but if it was,
I'm right here.
Thank you, sir.
No, I'm just saying that's my retirement plan.
That's
fine. I've been saving investing in Social Security for many years.
That's right.
That's my 401k.
I have 20 grand, damn it, and I want it.
But you know what I mean, though? Well, like,
I've got Social Security and a long, arduous divorce that took everything I attempted to save away from me. So,
yeah.
Divorces are the private government. That's right? The effect on wealth.
Exactly. You have no idea.
Well, I remember. Like, it's incredible.
Literally everything you see in this apartment, I bought in the last 3 years.
Oh, I remember you put your life together in a weekend. It was like, yeah, but we're still going to record on Thursday night. And I'm like, are you sure? You're getting a new car, getting an apartment, buying furniture, and you want to record Thursday. It's like, oh, yeah, it'd be fine.
I admire you for that. Yeah. Keep moving.
That bookshelf right there, that is literally the only thing that I brought from my house that was
and the cat.
That was furniture and the cat, yeah. So, no, divorce really, it messes you up for a while.
It's the great tax.
It does.
It's the hidden tax.
Which, after we take a break here, and I'm gonna do a little promo. But so let's finish up on this topic. Any final thoughts on this particular topic?
No, I think we have to do better. You can't, like, it's like what you experienced on that with the Matt Welch interview with Gary. Is it's easy to criticize, but we're beyond that point.
Yep.
Now we're at the nationally relevant stage where they're spending $50 million against our presidential candidate. Why are they taking us more seriously than we are?
Yep.
And you are talking about the point of the financing of the ads and the super PAC. That was the point we're
going to do that next.
Well, I think we've kind of covered it. I want to get into father's rights with you, if you don't mind.
I love that, sure.
But, yeah, we're talking about the hurricanes and government and private charity. And
roads.
And if you haven't listened to our interview with Rupert Bonham, we really go in-depth on private charity.
Yeah, I get it when – I saw Rupert at Morty's. Mm-hmm. I went from very much on the fence. I want to support this guy. He's a libertarian. To, wow, he's the real deal.
Yeah,
he's doing God's the work. We like if libertarians behaved like Rupert, we wouldn't have to worry about a safety net.
Yeah, but you know what?
Exactly.
Libertarians give Rupert shit because he's not Red Rothbard, and so he's suspicious. Like, the dude has been living the libertarian lifestyle, and he admits that he isn't the He doesn't know the ins and outs of purity, and no, he isn't always the best.
Then go vote for Daryl Perry.
Right. So
and his crooked teeth.
And has one-tenth of now, one-tenth.
He's really black and yellow. Black and yellow grill, black and yellow flag.
Now listen, Daryl's very nice. You don't need to be mean and petty like James Neese.
Neese has some allegations that made me rethink everything.
I don't know. Neese has...
But he has allegations on everybody.
Well, are we going to take James Neese as an investigative journalist?
Thug life, bro.
I'll be interested to see what he has to say about me tomorrow. I know I was mentioned in a comment. Well, I saw that.
But yeah. you're not a black and yellow libertarian, so you're fine.
No, he's already claimed.
No, I'm not.
He's the one where I got the ISIS thing.
I used to be until I ran for office.
Yeah. Well, there's nothing wrong with being there philosophically. I'm there philosophically. I can't go talk about private police to the average American citizen. You sound like an idiot, and you do more harm than good.
Yeah.
Go move to New Hampshire. Go meet Roger Paxton. He has a podcast. You guys can all go and talk about it. And then continue letting Trump and Bernie win your primaries.
People want to know.
Free state, Trump and Bernie.
On the Facebook Live, why your hand is so fidgety, and Christy commented.
Anxiety.
Because you're missing your phone.
There it is.
I want to do a quick promo for the Dispatch. That is our email newsletter. So when we get a chance to sit down and it's we aim for daily, but we're really getting it out 3 to 5 times a week. Greg puts together some links, which is an in-depth look at the news. It helps prepare you for some of the arguments that we're talking about tonight. Here's the reality of the world, and here's a framework. Secondly, I write a little, 300-word summary of that day's news or how I'm feeling about things or some sort of...
A little ditty,
a little pithy comment for the people out there. And there's also a meme of the day brought to you by We Are Memes. Shout out for what's his face?
Tad Western and Aaron Ewart.
And video of the day, too. So be sure to go to WeAreLibertarians.com and sign up for the email newsletter. Second promo, Greg Lenz. We have our first joint speaking gig.
I know. This is going to be fun.
Yeah. So we are actually going – our American Initiative was formed by Gary Johnson about four years ago, after he ran for office. And we're actually going to be speaking at IU on Monday night.
Monday night at 7:30 at the psychology building.
Yep. And we've put together some ideas of what we want to talk about, but you're going to have to come and see it.
Well, I still have my unseen meme presentation from the Rush County Convention. I never got it to deliver because Jeremiah Morrill didn't allow me to. A reconsideration of the 20th century in memes.
Alexander McCobin of Students for Liberty will be there. Rupert's going to be there. He's going to be speaking. And who am I forgetting? Who else is speaking?
The Pacemaker.
Oh, that's right. Little Brett Bittner. But we don't want to tell you that Little Brett Bittner will be there speaking.
Then you might not come.
On behalf of the Advocates for Self-Government.
Who are they?
The best liberty organization after us. So join us Monday night. Come see us do our shtick, our song and dance in front of the college kids. Rumor is that Gary Johnson and or Bill Weld, it's a non-political event because our American Initiative, it's like back in the days of Campaign for Liberty. Well, they couldn't be involved with Ron Paul, but Ron Paul showing up to this event. There's a possibility if the schedules match up from the campaign.
That, are you allowed to say that?
I don't know. I just did. So
I thought that was inside baseball.
No. Well, I'm saying there's a chance he might be there. I'm not saying he's going to be there. I literally nobody knows if he's going to be there.
I thought
they
were managing expectations on that one.
Well, yeah. I mean, don't expect to see Gary Johnson, but if you do, that'd be great.
Do you think he's not going to come if Bittner comes?
I think he's not going to come if you're there.
Why? I'm pro-Gary. I defend Gary. I hold him to higher standards than he does.
Do you know how much shit I took for you from fellow podcasters because of your Kendall interview?
Why?
That's when I started tagging you, because you were like, oh, yeah, listen.
But then I explained it to everybody, and they're like, oh, you know what? Yeah, that makes sense. And I was like, yeah, I'm not an idiot. I have high standards for Gary Johnson. I'm not going to apologize that I'm not just going to be a party bot that gets in line. I want him to hold himself to higher standards than I do.
And
he has to earn a vote. He's never going to be given votes by the majority of Americans.
He's got to earn more votes than...
And
the rest of the votes out there have to be earned, not given.
And yet he likes Donald Trump.
I do, because if Gary's not going to earn it, I'm going to give it to the fun person. He makes liberals cry. I've been waiting on that my whole life.
Are you telling us that Hillary Clinton isn't fun? I mean,
no, God.
Could you imagine her at a party?
I can't wait until she has a seizure in the next debate. I wanted Trump to trigger her so bad and just scream into the microphone to start, and she just starts shaking.
God.
Are you okay?
So, Drew, now you...
Epinephrine.
Now,
anyway...
I don't know what type of lawyer you are. You can or cannot say what type of lawyer you are if you want. I don't know the rules of lawyering. Okay. Now you mentioned that you're divorced. And through that process you learned a lot about father's rights. So I don't want to tell your story for you, but I think your perspective on father's rights, I think, is really important to kind of put out there and help people hear your perspective. So why don't you kind of start from the beginning? I mean, lay out your journey as a father's rights advocate.
Well, being a father's rights advocate to me is nothing more than being a father, really. I mean,
right.
And, the sister, mother, wife, or someone close to a father.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing I wanted to be, because Chris, one experience that we rather shared is, the sometime absence of our own fathers in our childhood. And it had an enormous impact on me. Thankfully, many, many years later, my dad and I are really close.
As my dad and I are.
great.
Now,
That's fantastic. And but my kids and I are not. And here's a quick synopsis on the story. Like I said, there's nothing more important to me than being a father. And I gave my kids as much love in the best way as I possibly could. Three daughters, beautiful girls. And, you know, growing up and doing things well in their lives, but at the same time, missing out on something really valuable to them, their own dad.
Right.
And that was after a long, long fight. So my kids were 12, 7, and 2, three girls, young when their mom and I divorced. And, you know, with the challenges that she had and a family behind her, well-connected in the local community, it basically over time pretty much forced me out of my kids' lives.
Mm.
And it was tough, and I fought for 10 years to stay involved, and eventually I had to make a decision that what I could and would do for them and for me and for the people around me was just keep moving on with my life and not continue the fight anymore. So after, you know, well over $100,000 in child support, and which is, you know, whatever it takes to raise a kid is worth it.
Sure.
But I just, you know, I make that point because the thought is that there's something about dads. Deadbeat dad is, you know, the old Bill Clinton, Newt Gingrich handshake deal and why we had welfare reform. Are there dads that are deadbeats out there? Sure. I got kids that tell me stories about that. But, you know, is it common? Not at all. In mm-hmm. fact, it's very, very rare. So what happens in our court system is that thanks to the way the federal government has set up the system, we have some really interesting things. Even right-wing feminist conservative recently passed, like Phyllis Schlafly, could publicly attack the Bradley Amendment. What's the Bradley Amendment? 1986, when the Tax Reform Act was passed and a deal had to be cut between Republicans, the Reagan administration, and the Democrats in the Senate. Senator Bill Bradley, who chaired the Finance Committee at that time, you know, was carrying a lot of the water to make this happen. He really wanted it because he wanted to run for president, too.
Sure. And he did in 1996?
I think it was 92. You got me on the – no, it must have been 92 because Clinton, yeah. I think, was unchallenged in 96.
Yes. Okay. So it was 92.
92. Yeah. So 6 years later, he runs – okay. So the Bradley Amendment says that any past due child support can never be forgiven. You can't reset child support retroactively. And in some ways, that sounds very, very fair. You know, you owed it. You got to pay it. You can't be forgiven. But you got to remember, anything government does is at the point of a gun, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it does it at the point of a gun, whether you've ever been, whether you've ever seen your children, whether you've been able to see your children, whether they're 35 years old at the time, whether you're 65 years old and on disability, it can't be forgiven retroactively. It doesn't matter if you've been on military service the whole time. And now it can't be forgiven. It can't be reduced retroactively.
Mm.
So you're stuck with it. And there's
and some of the formulations in some cases are just ridiculous. I mean, I have a friend that's paying child support. She's actually a mom, and the figures are it's an insane battle to go back. And a lot of times, what happens is, on both the side of the father and the mother, you don't want to go back and reopen anything in family court because sometimes that just puts everything on the docket, right?
Oh, it puts everything on the docket for sure. It absolutely does. I mean, that happened to me. If you're going to fight over, you know, you move from Michigan to Indiana so that you can get a better job, and so you're going to fight for a change in parenting time, what's the response to that? You owe more in child support. You need to fight over child support. You need to fight over what's included in child support, what medical expenses and so forth. You're going to have, now that you've moved 500 miles away, you're going to have 4, 5, 6 hearings in the next 6 months that are going to take you away from that job that you moved for to support your kids
right.
in the first place. It's exactly what happened to me. And you know, the reality is the point I'm making about the Bradley Amendment and especially about Title 4D of the Social Security Act, which was welfare reform, where you now have federally funded state courts, family courts, that are designed for nothing more than the collection of child support. And they give incentives for the collection of child support. So what ends up happening is every divorce with children has to have a child support worksheet attached to whatever is filed as a final order and decree. And when you do that, even though it looks really, really objective because it's calculated based on a formula, right? Mm-hmm. The things that you can plug into that formula can make it incredibly arbitrary. And not only arbitrary, I mean, it's not even the arbitrariness by itself that makes it unfair. It's the disproportionality of lifestyles that sometimes occurs and the hardship that it imposes on the payer of the support.
Explain that.
Okay, so many ways that can happen, but the classic example I would have would be the guy who's worked hard and paid support for a long time and had a well-paying job, and it could be a mother, because I've seen plenty of them. Probably, I think it's about 12% of child support orders are now paid by women, and it's increasing almost year by year. Someday it may be closer to 50%.
That damn wage gap.
That damn wage gap. It kills men when you're divorced. Yeah, it works in our favor until we're not paying, until what we're doing is not taking care of our wives at
that
all.
Increase.
Bad about women?
Yeah, sorry.
That wage gap.
The glass ceiling and Hillary Clinton?
Well, we were just.
Well, we hadn't got there yet.
We were just saying that, you know, there's an increasing amount of women who are paying child support as, you know, things increase on the women's side. So
yeah, there's more women female college graduates than men since like the 1920s, first time.
Wow. So the disproportionate lifestyle that you're talking about is the person who's paying the child support lives a lesser life than the person receiving it?
Yeah, that definitely happens. I mean, I've got a client right now who's in that situation. I don't do a lot of family law intentionally because of the emotion, the intensity, and so forth. I mean, I don't mind the intensity of the law, but the emotional impact on people's lives. I handle a few select cases from time to time.
I can imagine that would be really difficult.
And candidly, you know, the majority of my family law clients are African-American men from around the area, and most of whom have held good jobs for a long time and are faced with very difficult situations where they're at right now.
I feel like in family law, it's never not just extremely contentious.
Well, you know what? There are people that decide to make it amicable, but it has to be a conscious decision, and it has to be a conscious decision on the recognition that even if you're on the receiving end, the beneficiary of what happens, you're still going to come out a loser. I mean, the worst financial decision anybody can ever make, especially with children in the household, is divorce. It's the worst financial decision you can make.
It's a wealth tax.
True. Well, it's not only a wealth tax. That tax, a large portion of it goes to the court system.
Yeah.
And, which includes
giving you the privilege of breaking
up. So that's why I do family law. I'm trying to make back some of the money that I lost.
It's like Social Security.
No, but I do. I represent women who've been in situations where the father has just checked out, refused to pay child support that he owed, and should have continued paying it. And they're
fulfilling his obligations.
Really difficult situations. There's no easy victories. My ideas for what should be done in family law, level the playing field. Look, you know, Gary took a lot of abuse about baking the cake in during primary season. And he certainly didn't articulate his views very well.
You're going to bake that cake or you're going to wish there was a Holocaust. I love that meme.
I'm a believer in the lesser of government interventions between choices. If it means that you can't enforce at the point of a gun a business owner's right to exclude someone from a property for trespassing, and that person happens to be black or happens to be an immigrant or something, instead of, you know, the choice of the alternative of forcing that person out, then it's I believe in freedom of association. Create private clubs and so forth. But when you go into a courtroom, everybody, every person, I don't care if they're Greg Lenz, Chris Spangle, Drew Thompson, you know,
Mittens.
she should get gender rights.
If you are a party to a lawsuit and you have standing to be a party to a lawsuit, male, female, black, white, doesn't matter. You should be treated equally in the eyes of the law. That's what the Equal Protection Clause is all about.
Do you find in some of these family cases that black men are treated differently than white clients?
Good question. In Marion County, I'm going to say no. I think that I'll tell you what I do see is that if they're not represented by counsel, they're highly disrespected, and that's why they often, and that's why I, you know, probably have more.
Taken advantage of, for sure.
Yeah. You know, the women that I represent tend to be from out of state, where they're at a disadvantage, you know.
Yeah.
Because, you know.
Enforcement's probably tougher.
Enforcement's tougher, and they're treated as if they're the non-citizen.
They're not one of us.
And they're not, well, they're not going to vote for that particular judge.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, it affects you in family court all the time.
Oh, yeah.
If you're not...
It isn't blind justice.
I mean, I got to tell you, I think it's true. And I'm not going to... Look, I've been before a lot of very good tribunals in the state of Indiana. And there are times, though, when you have to recognize that if you're in a small rural county... and you're coming in from the outside, that if you're not representing a voter in that county, it's even where I find that the private individual has a fighting chance against the big bank because they're part of that community.
There's a community bank. There was actually a documentary.
They fund the school arts program.
There's actually a documentary about that very subject. My cousin Vinny. And when he
that documentary.
Yeah. Is that on Netflix? That
it's on Netflix.
Stossel, right?
Yeah. Was... Yeah.
No, it's interesting because there blind justice is probably a false ideal too. You know, there's so many real political and personal interests in the justice system because it's administered by men and women people, not, you know, it's not some algorithm you plug in the inputs and then out comes the decision and it's adhered to. Which would be nice, but that's probably a false – like that'd be like a blockchain for justice, but that doesn't exist either.
Well, and even if you say – you know, and I love Martin Luther King Jr.'s, you know, famous quote, you know, I want to live in a society where people are judged by the content of their color and not by the color of their skin. You know, the reality is try judging people in an even-handed way based on their content or their character because you know what? We all pick out different sets of flaws to key in on, right?
Should,
this guy doesn't have a good sense of humor. I don't like him.
Should, you know, there be almost a system where it's the arguments are made before one judge and then it's basically compiled and handed to a different judge that didn't hear the case? They just go through it objectively based on what was presented?
Well, I think are you talking about family court specifically?
Yeah, I mean just a court system where there's one that's almost the overseer, the steward of the justice process. Where everything's accumulated, done in an orderly manner, all the standards are upheld, then it's actually passed off to another justice who makes the decision after reading through the evidence.
Well, theoretically, we have that in the courts. You know, we've
got
a finder of fact and a trier of the law. So you guys know who Bruce Fine is?
I've heard the name, but I don't know Bruce.
Bruce, is he the constitutional lawyer?
You got
yep,
it.
Yep.
The guy who... represented our party in the against the presidential debate commission.
Yeah. Did something just happen with that? I thought I saw a news story that there was a new.
If it did, I missed that. That'd be great because if there's a different finding, it would be in our favor.
Right.
So, Bruce has taken on Indiana law constitutionally based on. So we have a great constitutional provision that says that juries are both the finder of fact and the trier of the law, that both the law and the facts fall to the jury's,
people.
Yeah, determination of the jury. Well, that's just not how you're taught in law school.
No.
So eventually the Indiana Supreme Court says, well, the Indiana Constitution doesn't say what it means. So
it's more guidelines.
Right. So it's, you know, his view is that has reduced the party's right to jury trial under the Constitution, which I believe he's correct on that, and I think
diminishes their standing.
Yeah, as libertarians, you know, one of the things biggest things we can do in the law is, you know, these issues like jury nullification. That's a powerful issue, really. Especially if you
it's the Trump card,
drug cases, civil forfeiture, and so forth. These are powerful issues. You don't have juries in family court. One problem, you know, I think it's a huge problem. How can it, you know, people have asked me, how can that happen to you? You're a lawyer. How are you alienated from your kids? You know, I don't believe it possibly could have happened if I would have had a right to have my case, evidence heard in my case before a jury. But because I had a magistrate that was answering to a judge that was beholden to my former father-in-law, you know, that changed the math tremendously.
Shocking.
Shocking that it worked out the way it did.
Had your own Thompson Global Initiative where people could make campaign or donations and then you could influence, you know, legal proceedings.
Have you heard episode 144 of our show?
Not yet. Okay. But apparently, I need to listen.
Amanda's story. If you go back and listen to Amanda's story, it is Amanda telling her story of domestic violence, and family court's basically put her on equal footing with someone who is allegedly raping his own daughter. I mean, and because she doesn't, and because they wanted to clear the docket. I mean, and wow. She is poor and can't afford a lawyer. And when you listen to this story over the course of 3 hours, if you're not a libertarian or damn near an anarchist by the end of listening to it, it's an unreal story that you can't believe that this happens in our country today. And both that and episode 91, Rachel's story, are really great examples of why we don't believe in the government. It's like we were telling our friend Caitlin from the Jeff Fibbert podcast, jefffibbert.com.
His assistant / intern.
Yeah, we basically said, it's not that we're against the same end goals. We want people to be helped. We want children to be protected. We want the same things that you want out of the world, you know, because people are broken and there need to be systems to fix things. But when it's done by force, you get a bureaucracy that causes more harm than anything.
Yeah, the hard part's administration. The easy part's passing legislation.
Right.
You know, the easiest thing in the world is crafting a well-intentioned law and then watching the bureaucracy get a hold of it and distort everything.
And it happens so
because
so,
it's administered
so
by men
so frequently. Yeah, but if we made it a little bit simpler and we said that equal protection applies in all courts for all reasons at all times, and we actually had some appellate court capacity for enforcement of that one rule, I think, you know, give people a level playing field. The stories that you tell, what I hear from women so many times, are battles that they end up having with child protective services. Mm-hmm. And it's
which does nothing of – don't confuse their name with what they do.
Which is right. This plays into that as well. And child protective services at the end of the day is completely useless because the family court just –
they're hamstrung.
The family court didn't even read the recommendations of
the judge.
Of DCS or of the DCRB or the criminal court. The family court just came in, and it's because the judge is friends with the husband's lawyer, and she was using a Christian legal team, you know, and so.
Well, they did argue the Old Testament, and that didn't work.
Right.
But you know, and that's a challenge too, and I hope that you know, I mean, so Neighborhood Christian Legal Clinic does a very fine job on the front end, but then right. they don't follow up and do the courtroom work.
They're resource strung. I mean, resources determine everything, you know.
Exactly.
You can't win the big battles unless you're so well-funded.
Yeah, and in these tough situations for moms in really difficult situations, I've you know, come up with some creative strategies for working with them. It's actually, though, still a lot tougher for the dads to come up with strategies like that. Where it's really tough for the moms is where they call you and it's, you know, a day or two too late. Their kids have been taken away from them.
Yeah, they're not a preemptive. There's not a preemptive type of thing.
Because they feel like they can't afford counsel, or maybe they really can't afford counsel, and or once they get court-appointed counsel, well, the state's already working against me, so now they don't trust the person that's been appointed by the court. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're not.
Sounds like they're already on the same side and trying to get hired by that side.
It feels that way. There's actually a lot more quality representation. I mean, our good friend Mark Rutherford has been the chair of the Indiana Public Defender Commission. There's actually some really good public defenders out there. There's some that really aren't that good. So, yeah.
Well, a lot of times, don't they contract those out to recent law school graduates for very low-wage contracts?
You know what? I haven't done that kind of work in a long time. I'm not sure. I know that in Marion County we have a team, a staff of full-time public defenders. They're probably not handling, you know, DCS cases or even child support cases. They're probably strictly handling felonies and things where representation is required.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. So
it's, you know, it is though so hard because it's – you want justice. That's the ideal. The blind application of justice and access to justice for every individual of society. How do you do it when it's humans are involved, relationships are involved? Blind justice is just – it's a standard that's almost impossible to meet.
I think it is impossible for humans to really meet that standard. I think we have to accept that inherently there are always flaws in the system.
Every time.
And the best thing that I can think of that has ever been done in human history toward achieving that goal is the Bill of Rights and then later the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution. If we give, as a libertarian to me, when people say they're strict constitutionalists, I'm strictly in favor of the Bill of Rights. They're pieces of the Constitution. I want term limits. I think we should have term limits. You know, there are things that need to be changed in my estimation within the Constitution. But our individual rights protected in the first 10 amendments are so
formally
valuable.
Protected.
Right.
that are
functional.
Allegedly, on a good day.
Yeah.
Right?
The Billish of rights.
Nobody really tries to take away our Third Amendment rights.
No.
Nobody even knows what they are.
Yeah,
right? They're not trying to house British soldiers.
Right. In your house.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's not happening
it's
yet.
It's their poor hygiene. Nobody wants a British soldier.
Yeah.
Their teeth.
I suppose it could be any soldier.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, freedom of the press has restrictions nowadays. You look at the Fourth Amendment.
The Fourth Amendment has been
decimated. Yeah, it might as well not be there. You know,
it's
the smallest obstacle on the world with a FISA court. You know, it's no issue whatsoever. And the Tenth was done by the Supremacy Clause. So you're looking at like now we're at the bill of potential prevention measures against big government.
You get the right to pay taxes for a giant government.
For rights you're no longer completely granted.
Right.
I mean, and even Donald Trump seemed to find nice private ways to get around the Fifth Amendment, which
yeah.
is the taking clause in the Fifth Amendment.
To make it work.
Yeah, I'm going to take it for Trump Towers.
Well, I mean, that's the thing.
And I'll let you know what just compensation is.
That's the thing, though, is it's easy to make. Well, we need to be reasonable. Like, the progressive message is always we don't need to be hamstrung by a document from antiquity. We need
right.
to be flexible, yada, yada, yada. Principles have to change with the times. That's where we can have progress. And that's the path to hell because at the end of the day, exactly. you can rationalize and justify anything, especially when people aren't watching. Then you have nothing protecting you other than mob rule and corruption.
So let me throw a question back to you guys. What would be the model for an appointment of a Supreme Court justice?
What would we want in a Supreme Court justice?
Yeah.
What would his
or her jurisprudence be, and what would that person look like in character, experience, and so forth?
Well, to me, first and foremost, it's original intent. I mean, in the mold of Scalia and Thomas – it's because I don't view, I think progressivism started by Teddy Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson and FDR and then LBJ, I mean, and Barack Obama and Bill Clinton.
Richard Nixon. The Republicans, too.
These are cancers that have to be cut out. And you have to, first and foremost, have a justice that believes in negative liberties. That the government, that these documents exist to restrain the government.
Right.
And
exactly.
that the government is not there to enable positive liberties, where we are going to make sure that you're cared for. And so it's.
You don't have the right to an income or
right.
living. You know what I mean?
So for me, it's the exact opposite of what Barack Obama outlined, where, mm-hmm. you know, the Constitution is a charter of positive liberties, and in that we can...
What can the government do for you?
Right, with the elastic clause and all those sorts of things. But because that's an actual clause, the good and plenty clause, what was when they were talking
necessary
about...
Necessary and proper?
No, the Barack Obama, during the Obamacare, there was one rep that you know, the
The goodwill?
Maybe it was. I don't know.
The general is the goodwill of the people. Like they justified it on the goodwill of the people, or for the common good.
Promote the general welfare.
Well, general welfare clause.
Right, but he basically made up his own clause in the Constitution.
Well, he didn't read it. Why would he read those?
Right. It was actually Conyers, I think, was that said it. But I might be making things up.
If you look at it, what the problem is that legal interpretation through the court process that, you know, going up and working its way up ends up becoming more important than the founding document. And that's where it just continues to build. If you made it where you couldn't cite precedent, where you couldn't cite legal interpretation by an appeals court in order to, you know, appeal to different justices that have grown up in a different time, then you would have a different looking country, and you'd probably have a better upholding of the Constitution.
Right. I don't think that it's necessarily.
So now I'm playing the Grand Inquisitor. So what would you do on your theories of jurisprudence, for example, with Roe versus Wade? Toss it out the door, and would you do that on the principle of original intent, given that we do have a Ninth Amendment? Where do you come down on a case like
states
that?
States' rights for me. Yeah. It's not in the Constitution, so it's delegated to the states.
Okay. Absolutely.
Okay, I'm with you.
Because the point is that Indiana would be pro-life, and I would want to live in a pro-life state as a pro-life person.
But to me, I've always made the argument that from a standpoint of jurisprudence, that overturning Roe versus Wade has very little to do with a pro-life position. It has everything to do with the inherent powers of the states, rather than the states' rights, but the inherent power of the states.
Well, they created the federal government.
They created the federal government to make such laws as are applicable to issues like abortion and the determination of
women. Anything unlisted or not enumerated.
Yeah.
Which is fascinating, because that does call into question the Ninth Amendment, which speaks of unenumerated rights.
Powers, yeah.
No rights.
Or yeah, rights.
Of the citizens. Okay, which you could hang your hat on to come up with something like Roe versus Wade, but how do you define – the problem with the Ninth Amendment is how do you define what's in the Ninth Amendment, the prenumbras to the Constitution? Yeah. Now, I want to say something about Thomas and Scalia, though, because this is fascinating to me. I was in law school, and Reagan chose Bork to –
Oh, God.
Yeah, and he was
– Sacrificial lamb.
Yeah, but he was the king of original intent. And I was still in law school when Scalia was nominated. Well, he was nominated immediately after.
Do you believe he was the moderate choice? You know what I mean? Like, the guy was the villain of the left for his entire career, and he was the one that was palatable to Ted Kennedy.
Because he was chosen at the same time as Rehnquist was elevated to the Chief Justice,
yeah.
Right. So then Kennedy actually was the moderate But
I'm talking about Ted Kennedy on the commission.
No, really. but I'm talking about Anthony Justice Kennedy. Kennedy, yeah. Yeah. So coming back to those three guys, though, Scalia moderated our moot court when I was in law school. And Scalia's position was, well, it's not really original intent. It's the plain language of the Constitution. It's the words of the Constitution. I'm a textualist.
Words on paper.
Words on paper, exactly, which I subscribe to. And I also like Thomas's jurisprudence, which is largely based on natural law, actually. Mm-hmm. And he made those arguments at his hearing when they focused entirely on Anita Hill, and they could have challenged him on – I think if they had challenged Clarence Thomas enough on his jurisprudence, he might have been eliminated – by his own caucus, by the Republican caucus. However, I think it was over his – I found Justice Thomas to be one of the most persuasive justices of our time.
Hmm. And why is that?
Because I think that he applies a consistency of opinions without trying to search through language to hang his hat on a decision. I think he is the most – plain outcome in terms of he's going with
simple like process.
Yeah. Now I wouldn't come out quite as conservative on certain law and order decisions as he does, but still, I think you know where he's coming from. It's a reliable jurisprudence. As an attorney, it's something you can look to and know where it's going. I mean, and the decision in Nebraska versus Colorado last year, and I'm going to mess it up if I try to analyze it too carefully, but the Supreme Court is there to decide disputes between the states. It refused to, okay? Hmm. And this is the issue. Come on, guys.
Well, what was the question in the case?
The question was, could Nebraska – it had to do with marijuana, enforcement of the of marijuana across state lines.
So if you got cited for a marijuana arrest in Kansas or in Nebraska, would Colorado fulfill the terms of the –
It wasn't exactly that, and I'm not going to
put it on the record.
I'm not going to cite it properly. What I am going to tell you is that Clarence Thomas was the only justice who dissented and said, "Look, this is our job. Let's do our job. It's specifically laid out
standard.
It's specifically laid out in the Constitution. We need, and they took a pass on it because they were afraid of the politics of the issue.
Which is the most ridiculous thing in the world.
Right.
The Supreme Court is afraid of the politics.
Right, because they will wander into politics where it serves the constituencies that they're a part of, that probably the cocktail party, since they have lifetime appointments. I'm actually in favor of term limits for the judiciary, and I get a lot of criticism from the bar. But the reality is, why are these guys up there for life anyway? You know, why don't we have some turnover in the federal courts? And I think we actually need more federal courts.
Well, even a tenured professor has things they can or can't do.
Right.
You know,
as Supreme Court, when was the last time you heard of an impeachment of a federal judge?
Right.
You know,
so, you know.
Yeah. Well, I don't think anybody pays attention to anything that happens in federal courts other than the Supreme Court.
John Roberts on Obamacare.
Well,
that
as
politically, like that, he became a public politician in that ruling.
We pay attention to SCOTUS, but my point is, who can name any other justice? Can you name any?
Trump's sister used to be a justice.
Right. Can we name
on the appellate court? Yeah.
I mean, I can name several of them in the Southern District of Indiana, but that's it.
Like
I couldn't name them. I can name on the Seventh Circuit.
And you're a lawyer,
Easterbrook.
You know, name the Supreme Court justices of your state. You can't. Most people don't even know the Supreme. I probably could name all seven Supreme Court justices
of the
U.S.
Okay,
That would be nine.
Nine. There you go. That's my point.
All 57 states.
Thank you, Senator Obama.
Yeah.
Nebraska.
Senator from Kenya.
The Nebraska and Oklahoma. What is Aleppo? versus Colorado. Whether the court will grant Nebraska and Oklahoma leave to file an original action to seek a declaratory judgment stating that Section 16, 4, and 5 of Article, I don't know, numerals 10, 15, 18 of the Colorado Constitution are preempted by federal law and therefore unconstitutional, unenforceable under any supremacy clause. Donald Trump's
preemption issue,
right?
Which you know, that's why they chickened out, because they love preemption. They love it.
Explain what that term means to the regular person.
Preemption was one of those extra constitutional doctrines that didn't come. See, I believe in stare decisis. I believe in common law, and it's a long, hard argument. I may spend the rest of my life. I'm going to argue two things in the Federal Reserve System. And let's fight for some restoration of common law in America. When it comes,
so you're a Tory, and you're on the losing side of the revolution.
I was on the losing side. No, because what happened in the Constitution?
They codified it.
They did. So we have the British common law,
but they don't have a constitution to protect them. But theoretically, ours are now just a worthless piece of paper.
So the doctrine of preemption.
Yeah.
So it's a creation of the Supreme Court. I cannot tell you. I believe it was shortly after the New Deal or during the New Deal era.
When he tried to pack the court, FDR.
Very similar time frame, I believe. It could have come much later. And the doctrine of preemption.
He was trying to put 27 on, right? It was 27 Supreme Court justices. No, I'm kidding.
I think it was 15.
I think it was 13 or 15.
Yeah. It was a few extras. They were gonna lean his way.
Some friendlies.
They started overturning his laws. So the doctrine, labor laws. Okay. So I mean, it's interesting in Indiana, right? I mean, this could come into play with like the federal minimum wage.
Yeah.
So funny thing is, if you're on the left and California or Washington creates a minimum wage that's higher than the federal minimum, then preemption is not going to come into play. Nobody's going to ask the question because you're raising the minimum wage above what they want. If you're a conservative, you're not going to question preemption in other words, preemption is a doctrine that says federal law under the Commerce Clause preempts the states. If the federal government has decided to legislate or regulate in a particular area, state law is superseded. In other words, preemption is what enables the federal government to have the power and
they're the standard, the platform.
The statism that we live by. It's a big reason why I ran for Congress. I'd love to throw out the doctrine, get the doctrine of preemption thrown out of Supreme Court jurisprudence. It's a horrific doctrine, in my opinion. So, and I wouldn't get much agreement from that from the bar, but if you found some good libertarian lawyers, Bruce Fine would probably be one of them, then, you know, absolutely they would. So under the doctrine of preemption, And when it comes to Colorado, that's why you can't go to the bank. You can't use a credit card to buy your weed when, you, when you're out in Denver.
Because the federal law
supersedes the state law.
But isn't there also specificity where it's whatever one is more fully defined and delineated?
you know a little bit about the case law.
Is that right?
It depends on the area of law.
Okay, so it's not a standard from
my reading of cases. So, for example, if you're talking about mortgage law, if you're talking about a foreclosure case, state law, the specificity is if the case arises in equity, then the state laws relating to foreclosure determine
they can actually trump the federal law.
They actually take precedence, and it's also a standard of procedure versus substance. If it's a procedural matter, then state law prevails if it's in state court. Federal law prevails if it's in federal court, but only if it's on a federal question.
Yeah.
Okay. Not if it's on diversity of citizenship. So there are all kinds of nuances to the doctrine of preemption.
A lot of conditions have to be met for these clauses to actually apply, is what
correct.
It's
It's not a clause, seems. It's a doctrine.
Or how this whether this doctrine is applicable, a lot of conditions have to be met.
Correct.
Which is just, at the end of the day, it's hilarious because the states created the federal government. Yeah. What was the point of getting the ratification if they didn't have the authority to create it?
I think that if we get away from a notion that of a sort of a racial bifurcation that says this is about states' rights and we're going back to the 1950s South, the Jim Crow laws, and we focus on the inherent powers of a state, and if we think about what we want state government to do, if we
emphasize what we were granted.
Right, but the problem there is a political language problem in that progressives see they want the federal government to have as much power as possible because you have the power of the printing press, you have war powers, you have the supremacy clause, and so.
But they're losing on those issues. They're losing. That's why millennials are moving to libertarianism because they want that. The Green Party is about community, communalism, and community. Get things local. That's what I that's the other
Govern
thing.
Govern local.
I, that's what I loved about the Green Party movement when I saw it in Michigan. Taste the local difference. Put local food on local farm to table. You know.
Yeah.
Go to your local grocery store. It's.
But I think a lot of libertarians identify with that as well.
Absolutely. So there's a movement on the left that's pulling, you know, in that direction. And so, and I think a lot of the younger generation, the millennial generation, is saying, you know, what the heck is a federal government? Yeah, Bernie Sanders is a hell of a great guy, but other than getting my student debt forgiven, what's he really going to do for me?
Well, what can he do? I mean, you think you really want to make a bigger government to handle Donald Trump? You're not going to, he's only can win for 8 years. And there's not like a whole army of mythical people that are of the same mindset as him to make sure that their bureaucracy is managed in that manner.
Are you sure?
You're going to create a monster and hand it to Trump?
The Trump children are.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, that's the danger of progressivism is you create a monster, you hand off to somebody you never imagined you'd have to.
Eventually that will happen.
The truth is that Trump is really only 25% of the Republican Party.
Right.
And then the rest of those people.
Maybe 35%.
I mean, his ceiling was at 37%, and a lot of that was, you know, people that didn't like the other candidates, but his base really is.
It's new 25%. Republicans, it's former blue-collar Democrats.
Right, it's 25%, but his ceiling is 37. And when you really break that down, 25% of the Republican Party is a very small amount. That's why we say, you know, these two people were picked ultimately by 9% of the country. And there are a lot of people out there that think like Donald Trump. And there is a cultural shift that is happening in society today because this is not a white Christian nation anymore.
No, it's not.
And
post-Christian.
Absolutely.
This is the majority of the voters, but it's not the makeup of the country.
Absolutely. And the country is in a shift in both identity, in jobs, in the way that the needs of education are not meeting the current demands for employers. I mean, critical thinking and problem solving and IT skills are at a premium. And we're teaching cursive. We're trying to argue whether or not cursive is relevant. And we're teaching.
Well, we're waiting for the Department of Federal Education to decide it's not.
Right. So it's.
They still may write in cursive there. They just haven't been in a school in 30 years.
So the problem is that we have so many different cultural shifts that are taking place, and we don't have forward thinkers who are articulating these anxieties, and Donald Trump is articulating these anxieties in a way. But not in an articulate way, if that makes sense. I mean, Donald
Trump.
Well, it's not only inarticulate. It also bounces back and forth between whether it resonates. I honestly felt like Hillary's best point in the debate, and she didn't have many. They were few and very far between. Was that there are a lot of people that Donald Trump, a lot of the people that. Theoretically would be supporting Trump, contractors, you know, construction workers, that he stiffed. He just walked away. He didn't pay them when he made a deal with them, and then he walked away from them.
The New York Times had the article about the guy who sold him $100,000 pianos, and he just never paid him.
That directly translates over to bureaucratic skill in a scandal-ridden organization and administration, because if you have to have competent people. You put someone that's a noob in charge of the United States government, day one there's going to be a scandal. Day two there's going to be a scandal. Day three. I mean, it's going to be – and the press is already going to be more hostile than they've ever been to any president ever.
And that's part of the problem with
and
Gary Johnson.
And they'll eat him alive. And same with Gary.
That's part of what my point with Gary was, is Gary can't handle the memes of society around his own campaign. How can he possibly expect to shepherd his legislation through the new media environment?
The hypothetical shift in the ticket that we discussed might have been the best.
It is. I've said that. You know? And I take heat, but
I just lost a 1,000 libertarian voters.
You know, like, because at the end of the day, the person with the plan is ultimately the leader of any organization, administration. The person that presents the plan first is the framework for everything from that point on.
Exactly.
We don't have one. Like Thomas Jefferson, the reason. He has founded the University of Virginia on his tombstone rather than President of the United States. He was more proud of that because he went into the initial meeting with a plan, and that became the rotunda. And that's where Jefferson scholars still stay into this day in the rooms he designed.
Yeah.
But like, because he set the terms at the beginning, he was the most prepared. Everything followed after that.
Yeah, and
that's what we need to do.
We are just not going to be successful as a movement if we can't handle – the memes that are spread about. I mean,
criticism.
When you look at, we talked about it in the previous episode about, you know, these clickbait sites like Raw Story, like Mediaite, like HuffPo,
BuzzFeed,
Daily Beast, BuzzFeed. Well, these are liberal leaning news outlets because of the people that make up. They're all based in New York or L.A. or Chicago in urban centers with horn rim glasses, nerdy. Liberal-leaning Bernie bros who work there, and they have a bent towards the liberal point of view, the progressive point of view, and so they're going to take something like Gary Johnson's joke or taking a statement and just – I mean, there was a Business Insider headline yesterday that was just flat-out ridiculous. It was just a fabrication, and they can get away with it and kill your campaign and kill your movement. And there's no retribution, and it's a real crisis of journalism and of community, just because they're not telling the truth. But whining about it isn't going to solve the problem because they're not going to change.
No.
Well, I have a critique that I want to offer for our own party, and it's a big one, and it's different. And I think, well, no, you guys. I mean, we've had times when we've disagreed, and I love you guys.
No, we haven't.
Okay, you're right. Yeah. Fearless leader.
Agree to disagree, Drew.
That's right.
No. And there's nothing wrong with that.
There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. What you guys do is fantastic, you know, and I think the same thing of the Libertarian Republic and heck, several other
Reason.
Podcasts. Yeah. Well, yeah, Reason's amazing. Fee is one of my favorite places to go for any information. But within our party, okay, we have really – zealous advocates for our issues. It's not about the zealousy of their advocacy that I have any problem with at all. I mean, I love if Daryl Perry was sitting here, he could throw things at me, say, you know what? Go ahead, break your pencil, say whatever you want. You know, as long as you're going to continue the fight for what you believe in, be come alongside me, fight for it, be in my ear, whatever. That's great. If you're going to say that I'm the all-out, let's take Austin Peterson, for example. You're the Austin Peterson diehard. I'll give my life for Austin today, tomorrow. I'll go anywhere, anytime. Lead me where you're going, Shepard. And then 2 weeks, 2 months later, you could care less what's happening to this party. Or because the other guy got nominated, you could care less what's happening to this party. What I am troubled by is that we have people that are so enthusiastic about stepping up to the plate. And they're so quick to go on to the next great thing, whatever it is. They give up on the opportunity for success.
False starts over and over.
Yeah, it's like we'll snap defeat from the jaws of victory however we can. And it's not it's not all the candidates. It's certainly not the media. But you know, we got to be serious about ourselves as a party.
And it's also our culture, the frenetic pace.
Individual.
Well, the frenetic pace of society today and the proliferation of choice. I was talking to somebody about dating today, and I just said, listen, dating is really difficult when you're, especially in your 30s, but in general, just because everybody has so many choices and everybody's looking to cut the best deal. And if you're a six and they're on Tinder and they find an eight, well, sorry, buddy. You know, you're out. I mean, it's right. And so
the free market competition sounds great until you don't get picked.
Yeah, exactly. When you're going through
You're Aldi's. Until there's Whole Foods over there.
Until you're facing a level two slump buster, you're real.
Then lobbying and protectionism sounds really good.
And then you're like, listen.
What happened to the good old days when
I need the
fours found fours?
We need Tinder legislation. We need equal access to dates on Tinder, and it should be
something
guaranteed.
Needs to disrupt Tinder.
I want a guaranteed right to swipe that I get at least one swipe right.
Where is the Bernie Sanders of sexual politics? So no, but that's how everything is disposable. You know, I have a bookshelf in the other room, and I was just like, well, I know I've had this like a month and a half, but it's only $20. I'll just throw it out. It's like
IKEA's got them on sale for $9, and it'll be new.
My grandparents never had that kind of mentality. You know, I mean, it's just
they kept everything.
Yeah, disposable consumerism.
Right. So
we had something called the gold standard back then.
Well, you know, but disposable consumerism is now being applied to people, and that poses a serious problem for us moving forward.
Our movement or to our culture?
To our culture, to us as people.
Because there won't be a commitment to wait and hold it out long enough for actionable change.
I think in general, having dedication to other people or a movement or an ideology or...
But isn't that everything we rail against? That, you know, don't be an adherent to your party. Don't just go along to get along with your conscience.
There's two different things going on there.
No, I rail against anti-intellectualism.
Yeah.
And I rail against blind faith.
Right, but you're saying, you know, stick it out even if you don't agree 100%.
No, I'm saying
and I'm not saying that either. So please don't.
Okay,
get me wrong,
that was the message I was getting, and I was like,
No, okay.
Am I going to vote for Bill Weld, even though I think Bill Weld completely planted that story in the Boston Globe? Absolutely,
he did. Was in a self-interest.
Here's what I think. You know, maybe we don't need politics. Maybe we can overcome it with Bitcoin and Uber and
technology.
Airbnb. And I hope we do. I hope we do. But if we don't, we've lived with the political system for 240 years, right?
And before that, every other.
And monarchy and all that other crap. So,
yeah.
You know, dictatorships of all different kinds. So if we're going to continue to be a political culture, if we're going to continue that, let's just assume we are for a while. If not.
We are social beings.
Well, we are. So, you know, here's what I've learned. I mean, look, if you want to come in second in a three-way race, have your name be an R or a D for this simple reason. There is machinery. There's registration. There's precinct committee people. There's a formula for success. If we're going to change that, if we're going to continue to be a political culture and we want to make a difference as a third party, I think we really got to take two things seriously. Not only do we have to learn to focus at a higher level, the message coming from the top, but really being spread at the levels of congressional and
strategic influence.
Strategic influence, okay. Not only do we have to have that mid-tier effectiveness, but we still have to have what we need at the grassroots more than candidates and electable candidates is we need to have a formulation for something that matters when we come to get out the vote. Look, they couldn't marginalize Gary Johnson with his answers, with his, you know, to questions.
Well, lack of answers.
Or lack of answers. Lack no, thereof. No. Yeah. They couldn't marginalize him if he was one of the other two parties.
Yeah.
It would be impossible. And they can't do that because they're going to get 37 or 8% of the vote. They're not going to get less than that.
It's factored in.
It's factored in. We need to be so effective that you know, our bottom tier isn't a zero get-out-the-vote effort with 3 or 4%. It becomes that 15% so they can't keep us out of the debates.
Right.
If I want to see anything by 2020, I want to go in knowing that we've got 15% in the polls.
Yeah.
Pick our candidates. Have that last day of our debates and know that whoever gets it's got 15%. And then Daryl Perry probably won't be on the stage at that point.
Well, a lot of it goes back to Alinsky's rules. Alinsky and the activist of the 60s, you know, helped build a movement. The Reagan revolution took place because conservatives in the 70s and 60s got serious about building a movement. Libertarians Correct. Have to get serious about building a movement, and that means cut the bullshit. Like,
yeah,
Daryl Perry has a place, Austin Peterson has a place, Gary Johnson has a place. Like, focus on your lane. Like,
true, but they also took over a party. We're not trying to take over a party.
Right.
We're trying to say, screw the old duopoly. We don't believe in that anyway. We got to build a new party. So even though 90% of what you said, 80, 90% of what you said applies, there's a 10 or 20% that's never been done before
sure.
that we got
to
do.
That's what was so frustrating to me about this race and the way it's turned out and panned out so far is I looked at it and said, well, given it's Trump, for the first time ever, you're looking at, rather than about 80% being factored in of Republicans, realistically 40% are not. There's about 40% of existing Republicans who are going to have to stomach or not vote, you know,
go elsewhere.
And yeah, and they are easily gettable with a credible, competent message that's more Bill Weldish.
Right.
And you get True. Enough of them to actually show up on election day with the right messaging and Bill Weld tapping into old networks. Rather than trying to reach for the Bernie, the disillusioned Bernie movement, which already doesn't vote because they're young, and two, they don't have money. And you tap into the country club, Mitt Romney network, Republican, that gets us, I thought, a better shot at getting our 15%. Now, that way, we don't need to be beholden to Bill Weld and be the party of Bill Weld, but that gets us our baseline, and then from there, we can run a real libertarian
with
public financing.
He's using us, why not use him?
Yeah, he can leverage us to get politically relevant again. We'll leverage him to get our base factored in, and let's pretend that we're country club Republicans just enough that they'll show up on election day and not want to have to claim Trump.
It's about getting people to push the button for the first time. And
I'm not embarrassed by Bill Weld.
What can you do? What can Gary Johnson do at this stage?
Nothing.
Now, to get out vote, to get his, you know, 10% out.
He appeals to youth. This is the worst showing voting block.
Here's the problem.
That's true, but I understand that. But you know, that's been a 10% movement vote that has changed the elections in the 80s for the Republicans and changed them in the 90s and 2000s for the Democrats. Why can't we, you know, take that off the table? Aren't there things we can do in the last 30
days? We can't offer opportunities in the long run.
I disagree with that.
If you are a young Republican or a young Democrat, you toe the line, you're going to get rewarded.
Mm.
It can be a career.
Yeah.
In the Libertarian Party, there's no path up.
But the dues paying that goes on in the Republican Party, from my experience, is having been a young Republican, is, you know, you've been there too, Chris.
You have to swallow a lot of crap.
Sure. Yeah, you.
And you sacrifice principle and everything, but it's your career.
In exchange, you get power, and that's we don't have power to
selfies
offer
with
yet.
Mike Pence,
right?
But do we want to, instead of offering individual power, you know, because that's not our message anyway. Our message is dissemination of power, the power to the individual. You know, it's in a way, it's a very democratic message. You know, your freedom is just as important as mine, right?
But power is power.
Alluring.
But see, here's the difference.
There's such a, you know, it's Potomac fever like in D.C.
But here's the difference of what
sure.
I'm talking about, what you're talking about. What I'm talking about is Greg and I do this podcast to build power. We right. want to influence the opinions of other people. We want to. We do this because we love it, and we want to learn, and we love to do this. And we think we have something to say, and we want to persuade people to hear what we have to say. So we want as many people to follow us and listen to us as possible, because we want influence.
Right.
Because
we'll get your messaging right.
Because we want things to be better. Mm-hmm. We're not after power to force people to do anything or sure. to control people. What libertarians have to do is build that kind of persuasive power, mm-hmm. And right. not the kind of coercive power that you're talking about, because there's different levels of power. Power is politics, it is important, and power means nothing but influence.
Well, I'd love to be on with you sometime in the next, after the election, somewhere down the road, and have that conversation again, because I can think about models within our party that are shaping up, and I'd like to see us really be able to build a coalition that's not personality based. That's really
because it can't be.
But that's
in the early stages, all movements are
sure. That's why dear leader. That's why dear leader must rise.
It's a necessity.
Yep. Mandatory freedom.
But then it grows, and they're competing. That's the problem. Libertarianism is just having growth pains. Libertarian Party. Yeah.
It is, and I think we've got to grow with the millennial generation. I don't see any other way it happens.
But if you are never serious, it won't.
Me personally?
No.
And that's fine if you do.
No, but no. What I'm saying, because you're not an example of this, what I'm saying is that when you ask me what can Gary Johnson do to be taken seriously.
Right.
Himself seriously.
The problem is that Gary Johnson should have been doing certain things 2 years ago, or has
preparing to be president like he was going to be it.
Right. And so
exactly. I can't disagree with that.
The emperor wears no clothes. Let me say this caveat, because I don't want people to be upset at me, because I'm voting for Gary Johnson because he is the best choice of the three. But there has been missed opportunities this year. There's also no pivot. There has been no pivot. It's just anger at something you can't control instead of saying, fuck you, I'm going to control this, and there hasn't been any campaign pivot. Nobody's been fired. There's been no change in strategy. Their strategy isn't working the way that it needs to work.
Well, I'm with you. I'm loyal to Gary to the end.
Sure.
And I'm loyal to Gary because, frankly, I believe in him. I've gotten to know him personally. I had lunch with him, had dinner with him, and talked to him.
He's the real deal. He's a genuinely great
person. He's a two-term governor.
Right.
In a race against a reality TV star and a failed Secretary of State.
If we put anybody else who put their name in, if it was Dr. Feldman, he wouldn't be here now.
No.
Right? So, if it was John McAfee, okay, we don't even need to approach that.
He couldn't go to a Central American summit because he's a fugitive in the country where it'd be hosted.
And Austin Peterson would be great in debates, and he'd never get close to the debates either. So,
it was the right choice.
It was the best choice we had. Now what we need to do going forward is build a stable of choices and, really create a situation where we're not dependent on, gosh, this guy.
We don't have a farm system. We wait for the people to leave other parties.
And the other point of that is that we don't know how to prepare.
But I don't know. I don't know that I totally agree with that. I see what's going on in Washington State and places in New York and Michigan and Pennsylvania and Virginia. Indiana is the best example of all. And Indiana's kind of created a stable of libertarian candidates. And a lot of that's thanks to your work, Chris. So.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You and Mark Rutherford, Brad Klopfenstein, there's a whole lot of people to be
laid the groundwork a long time ago.
They have. So in Indiana, we're poised to step up to the next echelon better than we are probably anywhere else. And you're right. I think in Indiana, we got this situation with a lot of gerrymandered districts. Yeah, I can see why if you're the head of the Indiana party, you salivate over the idea of having a candidate running in every state house district. Because he get a second place finish over and over and over again. We become the alternative party pretty quickly if we fight that battle enough. But, we got but we're also a straight ticket state, and we've got to solidify our coalition. And Gary Johnson's our standard bearer, and I just want to find a way as this election comes to a conclusion to say, hey, you know, look at the choices that we have, examine them carefully, and think about where we go at. Yeah, Gary Johnson needs a lot of help and support, but, you know.
He's not corrupt. He's not crazy. He's not ill. He's not, you know, there is, and that's my argument. And I may be critical, but I'm also not a blind faith guy. I think, you know, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton are infinitely worse, and Gary Johnson's worthy of your vote.
Right.
But when you ask what can he do now to change certain things, the things that we're criticizing, he would have had to have done.
Long
like
ago.
You walk in here
last
and
he ran for president.
Well. There's also new wrinkles like getting beaten up in the press. That is brand new, and
But that's from a failure to prepare, like he was going to win.
Right.
Yeah.
And he's already run once.
You're right. Right. And I mean, what I want though for this party is for folks that are running for offices like I am. Andy Horning has toiled his whole adult life to see. Now you can
shouting in the darkness until he got noticed.
And well, sometimes he gets less noticed after more time. So you know, what I want to see is our party create opportunities in the media that we can be noticed, and so that we can, you know, let me take my hits in front of Matt Tully and Abdul and Greg Garrison. I want to go toe to toe with Garrison so bad.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm not going to get that chance. And you know what?
If you got to pick a fight. That's the hard mindset. And I know that. You're not afraid of a fight. But they are.
Well, it's a couple things. I mean, I didn't. The time to pick the fight is the time to pick the fight.
Right.
And for me, if your mission is what my mission is, it's not in the last 30 days of the election cycle.
No. Yeah.
It's, you know, it's another time and another day. And I'll pick those fights.
Oh, yeah. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about, like, Austin picked the fight with Gary Johnson to an almost first place finish.
Yeah.
And it's because he had to pick the fight, be abrasive, be seen as a little bit of a prick in order to get enough to be noticed and stand out, and then build a coalition around that because people were discontent.
There's a difference, though, between, you know, I'm going to say
that in the media.
Well, if okay, so could Gary Johnson, for example, have picked a fight with Trump and been a lot more effective, picked a fight with Hillary, either one of them? Loved it if it was.
Oh, you can lure Trump into a fight all the time.
Exactly.
Absolutely. And get disillusioned Republicans. That was my whole criticism of the strategy.
Could have been a great idea. Could have been a great idea. But it's still different.
Still got a month.
it's still different to do it in a intra party battle than it is
right.
Than it is once you're in the general election cycle.
Austin,
so
Austin hurt Gary with the bake the cake thing, and
you got to draw blood because you have to find the one thing that actually draws blood that people notice.
Yeah, it's a wound that's still festering.
You just have to keep throwing bombs until something finally hits. Like
right.
Rick Perry was the only person that could draw blood against Mitt Romney in the 2012 primary process, and that's why he leapt to the top.
Yeah.
He drew blood by annoying Romney and getting him out of his composure, and that immediately let him rise as the second in command.
Yeah, so what I'm looking forward to is a conversation about 2020.
There's also
Gary should have challenged Donald Trump to a masculinity challenge, like a fitness challenge publicly.
Gary,
because you're so macho.
I want a discussion in 2020 more than anything else. If Gary's president, are you better off or worse off than you would have been if one of these other clowns had been elected?
But in order to say,
if he's not, you know, what could happen with a libertarian presidency in 2020 versus what we have today? And it's not because of Gary Johnson or not because of Gary Johnson.
Right.
It's because we have a platform. We have a distinction in what we want to do that is so significant and valuable that that there's going to be a time when
relevant.
I mean, people have to come to us.
It's relevant.
If we're going to have a political culture, they have to come generally in our way, and the only way we lose it, I think, is by not doing what we need to put together what needs to happen to make us a winning coalition.
Yeah, and a lot of it has to do, though, with I hate to say it, but central planning is very effective in moving an organization forward.
Absolutely it is.
No,
and that's antithetical to our nature.
Well, yes.
We let everybody play. We include everybody.
Fuck those people.
I know. I'm not, like, yeah.
Central plan.
Frankly.
Well, that's the thing is we're not big enough. We can silence people. We still have to build coalitions with people we don't want to touch.
We absolutely are. Nick, if there's anything that we've learned from, you know, the best thing about our convention was seeing that Sarwark's method of running the convention has power in itself.
Yeah.
There is, you have to have equity. You have to treat people equally. And you have to make sure that voices are included. But at the same time, once you set a strategy, you got to start moving forward. And if people like Roger don't want to support Gary Johnson and don't want to support Bill Weld, then see ya. And that's their
prerogative. Start the Voluntarist Party. Like, there's nothing wrong with
that. Right. There's nothing wrong with that. That's why the Conservative Party was started. And that's, you know, the Buckleys ran under that in the 60s and 70s.
True.
I mean,
true.
It's...
And I totally agree with that, by the way, Greg. If the person in the party is not your person, or if you've got a fundamental difference on ideology or even strategy, you can make a decision to jump out. I mean, there's so many Republicans that I know well that are in fairly high places or very high places now that have stuck with the party, I think, too long for their own good, or too long for what they believe in and for what they've been fighting for their whole adult lives.
But they have to have a viable alternative that they're comfortable admitting ownership. Like, that's the problem. Like with the James Weeks thing,
Just give you an example, though. If Club for Growth, for example, if they had gone out and said to Rand Paul, you know, we'll get behind you if you run as a libertarian, you know. I mean, their issues are better served within the Libertarian Party than they are within the...
Except we don't have access. So, like, they know that getting behind us isn't going to give them a seat at the table, so they have to go to the second best choice. For now. In time, we'll be at the table, but we're not there.
I think that is probably their assessment, yeah. And I think it's more than... their assessment. I think they'd still fight for the Republican Party, even if they thought that we had gained as much access.
That's where they go when they're not in an election year. They go work there.
Right. So, but at the same time, the reality is, if they gave up their love for access and were, you know, fundamentally ideologically honest, then they could help turn the way the elections are going. And I'm not saying that's going to come easy. That's going to come very, very
It takes
hard.
Courage by a leader of an organization to do that, to say, well, you know what, we're going to back Gary because Trump is not free trade.
Well, not only that, how many million-dollar checks have you ever written?
Yeah, right. I mean, that's the thing. Money is the mother's milk of politics.
I've written a lot of million-dollar checks. They just didn't go through.
That's called fraud.
You just didn't. Oh. They didn't leave the front
door. All I had to do was pay $24.95 for the return check fee.
I wrote them, took a picture of them, tore them up before anybody got a hold of them.
Yeah. I mean, it is hard, though. At the end of the day, Gary ran the most successful presidential campaign of a Libertarian candidate in history in 2012, and he lost by 57.5 million votes to the flippin' Mormon.
Yeah.
There's a lot of work to be done.
Well, yeah, there's definitely a lot of work to be done.
And this is a huge opportunity. That's what just drives me crazy, is I don't know when the context and the situation is going to be as favorable to us as this. Getting
years.
Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton
actually,
is a gift from the gods.
In two more years, if we will pay attention to legislative races wherever we need to. You know, if I was in another state, I might run for attorney general if it wasn't on the ballot at the same time as the governor and the president. But I'm not going to do it here.
But I just mean, like, we'll get public financing. This is the best shot at public financing we'll ever get.
And I like it.
And I don't think we're going to hit the number.
Yep.
Because if he gets 4 million votes.
Great. Can you mute him?
Well, not. I mean, I'm just saying. No, it's not that I pray to God we do.
I mean, he's still, with everything that's happened, he's still pulling at 8%. Come on.
But he was pulling at 6 to 8 last time and got 1 million votes.
Yeah, he's got to start swinging. He's got to. He's
all really, blood. He really wasn't. He wasn't pulling at 6 to 8% at this stage.
The national.
No, he wasn't.
No.
He was pulling about two.
Four years ago, he was lucky to get 2.
Oh, yeah, was he really?
Oh, yeah.
Right at the time of the conventions, he was pulling at 6-7%.
In 2012.
Yeah, but not at this stage of the game.
But he's been included this time, too, which bumps the numbers up. You know, when they ask the question, it's not, you know, he's getting more access. The whole situation's changing. But I just hope Gary.
That might be the best news that we can get out of it.
Here's what I would say is that Gary.
Well, we don't know if we're going to get a race this favorable ever again for presidential.
No, we will.
Yeah, we will.
Donald Trump and Hillary, the two it's basically Hitler and Stalin versus anyone else. Doesn't happen all the time.
Are you kidding? McCain versus Obama? How could it get any
worse?
They're
both way more likable.
Yeah.
People didn't have any of the issues.
Trump went after McCain.
But so. You have two candidates that their parties don't like them. Like, that doesn't shape up that. One isn't barely a member.
And the truth is that, you know, I could sit down. If Obama, I was saying this to last night at Silver Circle. If Andre Carson came in, and I know he doesn't drink, or they say he doesn't drink anyway. If he came in and wanted to have a beer, I would sit and have a beer with him, and I'd watch football with him. You know, I could get along with him. Same way with Obama. I could play basketball with him if my knees would hold up. You know, I mean, I could. But Hillary, seriously, who would want to go to tea with her? I'm not trying to be, you know, angry or vitriolic at all. I just think the reality is...
No, just we're literally asking someone to come forward and go to see with her.
Unlikable person.
Please, be my friend, please.
She's every bit as unlikable as Trump. I mean, that's the thing is that there is...
Actually, she's much more... Trump is actually... has a measure of likability.
His people at least like him.
Right.
It's a small group, but they like him a lot.
There has to be something to Hillary, though, because you think like...
Fear.
But think of Bill Clinton's proclivities... And his love of women, and he married
a Rodham.
He married Hillary,
but a Rodham.
Oh, money!
If you've been a divorce lawyer, the guy who is the biggest philanderer will typically marry the girl who is
he
just
can get
not
away
interested. That's not interested in the sexual part of their
strategic.
Life.
Yeah.
Ah,
really? That's my observation. That's the gospel according to Drew Thompson. But yeah, it seems to me.
Why do you think that is?
So, in a study of human psychology, I think that the guy that wants that kind of lifestyle is seeking the path of least resistance, and you know, and I don't know that that's where Bill Clinton. And I also think it evolves over time. I think, you know, like with Bill and Hillary, I mean, probably what he was thinking about when he married her is, damn, she came from a good family in Hinsdale, Illinois, and she's. Damn good lawyer, did well in law school, and she's organized, and this could work. This could be quite a partnership, and she's not very good looking, and you know, and
but she has the connections.
Probably started. I gotta believe he was not faithful to her when they were dating for a long time.
Yeah,
yeah, and so that all came about.
That was his ticket, though.
Right.
Like, you know, that was his ticket into the upper echelon of American society.
You know, I mean, how did he get the Oxford scholar? Rhodes Scholar.
I don't know.
Yeah, nobody.
Well, I mean, he is as.
Did her family have anything to do with it? I doubt
it. Oh, no, he was like legendary in law school. Mm-hmm. They said it was incredible. He didn't take notes. He just sat and he would listen. And he didn't take notes in law school. And they said he was incredible at being able to tell you exactly what was going to be on the exam because he just had like an understanding of what the professor cared about based on how they talked about it.
You know, the funny thing is, though, I knew that guy in law school. And I'd say his name, but if he's possibly listening or some of our friends from law school are, I don't want to embarrass him. And my classmates know who he was, too. And a guy went and took the bar exam and failed it. First time.
And then he became Saddam Hussein.
Well, I mean, Joe no, Joe Biden failed at what, like four times?
Yeah.
Five times?
Is that a fact?
Yeah, because he graduated from law school.
If he failed the bar exam, there's hope. Well, you know, if you look at Joe Biden has learned his trade of politics very, very, very well. Very, very well.
It's all he could do.
But you know what? he is as corrupt as, I mean, you know, the difference between him and Hillary is a likability factor.
Yeah.
He is every bit as corrupt as she is.
Even I like Joe.
Yeah, I mean, he's hard not to like.
Well, that's the thing is
he's a son of a bitch.
He couldn't pass the bar, so he runs for the Senate. Ends up getting lucky and winning at 29 and then gets an appointment to the lowest man on the totem pole for Senate Foreign Relations. I mean, he's 29 years old and he was the worst kid in his law school class at University of Delaware. Like,
well, he didn't get elected to the House.
Straight to Senate.
Straight to the Senate, yeah.
But you had to be 30 to be elected.
Yeah, but he ran when he was 29, when he was sworn in, he was 30. I mean, he's sitting he's sitting in Russia, Soviet Russia. And told it was just below Gorbachev, and he got in trouble for it because he said, you can't shit a shitter. And he wasn't supposed to speak at a foreign delegation and said, you can't shit a shitter when he was in his early 30s. Like, he's been Uncle Joe since he was a young man. But he's a politician only.
This is really big.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we got to wrap up.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's do.
Okay. So at the end, we get to, if you want to self-promote, if there's anything that we missed, or it's just open season. So you get a couple minutes to just talk. You can go first, or you can let Greg show you how it's done. It's up to you.
What should I do, Greg?
I'd self-promote if I were you.
All right. Well, you know where to find me, DrewThompson2016.com.
And what race?
7th District here in Indiana. It's the southern three-quarters, two-thirds of Marion County, running against Andre Carson. So look for both of our names on the ballot. Vote for me.
What can a vote for you – what will a voter get? What three things will a voter get if they vote for you?
Thank you. I really appreciate that. One thing I'd like for anybody to do, you can look at my page and look at any of our congressional delegations page or candidate delegations pages and see the Compact for Liberty that we signed. It's a 10-point compact. Talks about all the things that we stand for. If you want me to pick three things out of the 10, here's what you can get. You're going to get a true look at regulation, a vote for deregulation, which means that the Code of Federal Regulations, which could fill up the largest hotel ballroom in Indianapolis today, if we could have our way, cut it by 10% a year with every congressional session, 20% every congressional session for the next 8 years, then we'd have a reasonable code of federal regulations. We want Congress to do its job and legislate and maintain a separation of powers, not turn it over either to the federal government or to the states. Just keep legislation where it belongs and keep it simple, stupid. So in curtailing regulation, it's hamstrings business. Even Bill Clinton's out there on the campaign trail saying that the craziest thing in the world is how you try to figure out how you're going to afford health insurance if you're a small business owner under Obamacare. So that'd probably be number one. I think we got to make a lot of structural changes in our system around things like term limits and gerrymandering. They're enormously destructive. What happens is that when we elect kings and bishops and, you know, dukes and rulers, we almost have a monarchical system, except the power is, even though we don't have a parliamentary system, the power is vested in those lifetime elections of congressmen and senators who serve so long and never have to come home and be really accountable to the voters. And true, it is on the voters that they don't make them accountable, but when we have a so-called two-party system and we gerrymander districts so that one party or the other is going to win, as long as the same guy keeps running or girl, they're going to keep winning. So those structural changes are really important to the system.
Electoral reform, then?
Electoral reform, absolutely.
Deregulation.
The third point, it's almost a toss-up, but it really comes down to the same thing. Because while I think that, you know, once we have a system that, remember when Bill Clinton first got elected, he said, I don't want to raise your taxes, but I have to. So I'm going to do it disproportionately, and I'm going to go after the rich guy out there, the Donald Trump out there.
And then he had to pay he had $900 million in losses as a result.
But
I'm not that's not a criticism of Trump or his accountants. I think more power to
him. Legal.
That's right. The point is that no wonder the audits have been so long. We've spent more money, so much more money trying to collect taxes from Donald Trump
from 1987
than we've collected. Hence, let's face it, folks, the income tax doesn't work. Let's get rid of it and let's be done with it forever. But more importantly than abolishing the income tax and the IRS, to me, is the Federal Reserve. And I wanted to spend the whole night talking about that with Hurricane Matthew and everything. I mean, the Federal Reserve does nothing but create debt. That's what it exists for, is the creation of debt. It puts money into the economy, however it gets in the pockets. First, however, it gets in the accounts of banks is through debt that has to be repaid to the Federal Reserve, and then it goes out into the economy through debt. Our system only creates financial viability through debt. If we can move away from that to a stable currency, to alternative currencies, local exchange trading systems, and through an equity-based profitability system instead of a debt-based profitability system, we can do a lot for our economy, and we can turn it around a lot faster than if we continue down the course. Anything we can do in the
fix course. America's debt problem so we can start growing again.
Exactly. Yep. So those are rather complex ways of saying perhaps what you just summarized for me, which is, you know, $19 trillion in federal debt isn't working for anybody.
Right.
The income tax system doesn't work. Let's kill it and make it go away. We're overregulated. We're beaten to death with regulation. Those are all economic issues.
And you don't have a fighting chance because the politicians have ensured they're going to keep being reelected.
Exactly. So if we reform the electoral system, then your personal social freedoms are going to be protected a lot better because now they're subject to be taken away by people you have little control over whether they're going back to office because they probably
They made sure you didn't.
Exactly.
Gregory?
There you have it.
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to thank Drew for coming on. I hope you enjoyed it. It was tolerable, and your candidacy isn't ruined.
Yet.
Usually that's what happens.
Keep going.
I haven't gone yet.
We've yet to. Oh, God. But, no, just thoughts and prayers with the people down in Florida, and especially your grandparents.
I got this. I'll end on that. Go ahead.
But, yeah, watch that, and watch how quickly it's politicized, because – Lord knows everyone will be salivating once the tides have regressed or recessed to start jumping all over it.
And the images are there in front of our eyes.
We've already had a news alert as we've been sitting here that Rick Scott refused to extend the voter registration period. And so Hillary Clinton requested, and so she's crying foul. So it's already begun, and the storm's not even in Florida yet.
Crooked Hillary got some crooked.
Right.
Boy, and they didn't have three years and 11 months wasn't long enough.
It was the best joke that I saw this week. It was
well, nobody does study to the test until the deadline. You know what I mean? Isn't that weird?
It's a tough test.
Yeah.
It was not only are George W. and H.W. Bush going to vote for Hillary Clinton, so is Ronald Reagan, Gerald Ford, and Richard Nixon.
I saw that.
I love that. That's the meme of the week.
Yeah. That it?
Oh, no. And then Mike Pence was feeling his oats after the win. Did you see him give his stump speech at Reagan's library?
I did not.
It's a new Mike Pence.
Yeah.
Really?
He was so, like, assertive energized. And feel like, oh, my God, everyone in America doesn't hate me. Like, and you could just tell he was, like, not kind of walking on eggshells. Like, he was very his demeanor changed completely. He had the Bushisms like I've never seen. Oh. Like he did the, well, I can see you, and pointed to somebody. It was amazing to watch.
Donald took credit for his great performance. He said, boy, did I do a great job.
We made Mike Pence great again.
Coaching that boy.
Yeah, he took full credit. I made such a great decision. After rumors that he was actually upset with Mike Pence for doing so well and upstaging
him. You guys fall for this over and over. He did that so no one could talk about anything else, and Trump would be the only word said in the news cycle for 24 hours. He hacks the press every single day.
I think he does.
And it's a joke. It's not real.
It's effective.
It's like he thought he might change his mind the night before announcing Pence. He wasn't changing his mind. He wanted to dominate the news cycle so Hillary couldn't get on.
Yep. All right. So we will be here on Sunday night. We are going to cover the debate. Again, as we did for the VP in the first debate, we're going to record live from the studio so the sound on Facebook Live will sound good, as opposed to the Morty sound, which didn't sound as good, so tune in. Final note for me, I got a note for my aunt as we were sitting here, and my grandparents ended up going to a shelter, so that is a huge relief, because I'm sitting here and somebody...
Worried.
Yeah, I was sitting here, I was actually pretty worried, and points where I've been quiet tonight. I was messaging back and forth with family on what we were going to do, and they ended up going to a shelter. Their grandma's not happy about it, but they're at least safe, and I'm looking at this map from the PBS NewsHour where it's going to cause the worst flooding, and you see that red right there on St. Augustine Beach? That's where they live. That's greater than 9 feet, so...
Jeez.
They're you know, it could have been a really bad situation. And so that is an unfortunate reality. There are a lot of people out there, like in my grandparents' situation, that don't have, well, I won't get into the whole story of my grandparents specifically, but there are a lot of people in their 70s and 80s who can't or will not evacuate for whatever reason. You know, a lot of it is once you get older, you don't want to break your routines, and the fear, you know, there's a, you want to deny, or you just don't want to.
Well, if it's going to be Trump or Hillary, what's the point anyway?
Right. So, yeah, but so there's going to be a lot of people who are going to be struggling, and hopefully we don't have any losses here. The sad news out of Haiti that there's been over 250 deaths there, and they have relief teams haven't even gotten to the worst parts, the poorest parts of Haiti. So that toll could rise climb, so yeah, rise dramatically. So please, if you are the praying kind, please send out prayers. I will not say send out good vibes.
Healing vibes.
I do not believe in them. I believe that you should pray.
I'm operating at a high frequency right now, Chris.
See, Drew, here's the thing. Prayer is the same thing as good vibes, but people say good vibes because they're ashamed of saying prayer, and I think it's stupid. You should be proud of what you believe, and if you're not proud of what you believe, then you shouldn't believe it. You should just go straight to hell.
Say what you believe, and if you well.
And a lot of that is what we're talking about with the Libertarian Party, and stop being passive. Say what you believe. A liberal came on my Facebook page this week, and you know what I did?
Trumped him.
He tried to say, oh, you're just going to take us back to the 1800s. So I started posting Margaret Sanger quotes and Woodrow Wilson quotes.
Good for you.
About how they hated black people and wanted to kill black
genocide.
Babies. Black genocide. And then you know what he did? He ran like a scared little bitch because of his glass chimneys. So it's listen, Donald Trump has set the mold. It's
true.
You don't have to be awful and call people fat pigs, although I do. But you
don't let fear, like, that's right. The problem is the and I would say the right, but like even libertarians feared backlash from the left for so long. And that's what I loved about Trump, is he was the big punch in the face everybody's been waiting for.
Right.
That, oh, I don't have to feel bad anymore. I can stick my head out of the hole. I can say these things about what they actually did and how awful they are without being a racist.
Plenty of times Donald Trump has done that.
Well, I mean, he gave everybody space to come back.
Donald Trump has punched your mother or...
Oh, yeah, but I'm saying, like, it's no longer a culture of fear.
Libertarians forever, because I've been around the movement forever, it's hard to explain to Greg what it's like to be a Libertarian Party person for the last 10 years. But a lot of it is just wanting to be desperately want to be liked. And when you want to, when you give off this scent of pathetic desperation that people are not attracted to when you have that mindset. And, you know, we want to be liked, so we want to play it safe. And I'm not talking about wearing the Hawaiian shirt to the televised debate. I'm saying have the courage of your conviction. That's why people respect Austin Peterson. Probably, if you're talking about rank-and-file libertarians that I see on Facebook, there's more respect across the board for Austin Peterson than probably Gary Johnson.
He doesn't apologize for his libertarianism.
Right. He punches you right in the face with his beliefs. And conservatives and libertarians have to start acting like liberals and stop apologizing for thinking things are right. Right. And that they are that way, that they are supposed to be that way. So, you know... And the second thing, when you're in discussions with these people on your Facebook page, when you've got a liberal troll, because it's always the liberals, it's never the conservatives troll a little bit, but then, yeah, we're bros.
Then in comes cool. A block of text from a libertarian.
Well, just attack Trump a little bit. You can
yeah, you can attack Trump.
You can draw in the conservative trolls.
So. Oh, yeah.
But then you get some, and I'm sorry, Drew, some leftist cunt rag that comes in. I'm thinking about you, Kevin Strunk, who comes on my page and, you know, wants to troll. And you know what? You out-troll them. You punch them right in the troll face.
Physically removed, so to speak.
They've got
to
go back. So, you know, Anthony, Kevin, you got what was coming to you this week. I haven't escalated to Greg and putting your child's faces on fleshlights yet. You keep it up. That's what's coming. Because I'm going to win the Facebook argument.
I will not be out trolled. I'll clear my schedule for the entire weekend.
All right. Well, thanks so much to Drew Thompson for joining us. He is currently in the bathroom, but he thanks us for him being here, I'm sure. Greg Lenz, thanks to you for being here as well.
And I'll see you Sunday.
I'll see you Sunday, and thank you for listening. If you are listening at the three-hour mark, then you are a wonderful, Minch. Dear listener. And to the eight people that have been watching on Facebook Live the whole time, you especially get a gold star. Thank you so much for joining us here on this episode of We Are Libertarians. And as always, we promise
to do better next time. All right.